Welcome to the Alex Jones Show on this Thursday, August 6, 2015. Of course, tonight is the beginning of the debates. We'll have the first one eagerly awaited. Everybody is curious to see what's going to happen, as one of John Kasich's advisors said when talking about the possibility of what might happen tonight. Everybody is concerned. They don't know what Donald Trump is going to do. And one guy said, well, it's kind of like trying to prepare for a NASCAR race when you know one of the drivers is going to be drunk. Well, I don't think Donald Trump is going to be drunk. I think he's going to surprise them with his passion. A lot of people are interested to see them get off of their set talking points. We've seen this happen over and over again. You know that if they're a governor, they're going to talk about how they lowered taxes and they created jobs. More jobs than anybody has ever created in the history of mankind. And they did it all themselves as governor. If they're a senator, they're typically going to talk about how sophisticated they are about foreign policy, how they've supported every war, how they built the military to a giant level. But we're going to talk about that because, unfortunately, probably not going to hear, even from Rand Paul, any pushback against building the military tonight. Rand Paul has been the least belligerent, the least interventionist by far of all the candidates, so much so they've got a political pact that is going to be attacking him. They've set up that pact just to attack Rand Paul. But he still wants to grow the defense budget. He wants to offset it with cuts elsewhere, unlike many of the other candidates. But he still wants to grow it. We're going to talk about where this is all leading. Today is the 70th anniversary of dropping the bomb on Hiroshima. And we're going to look at this from a different perspective. We're not going to talk about the politics of it. We're not going to talk about the military strategy of it. We're going to talk about it from the ground level, from some of the surviving eyewitnesses. What did they see? And what do we expect to see with all the money that we're pouring into the military-industrial complex? So we're going to talk about that when we come back. Also, we're going to talk about the newest movements to attack the right to keep and bear arms. Of course, we had this theater shooting yesterday, and everybody said, this is terrible. You know, the only person shooting, the only people shooting really was the police. Purportedly, this guy who had a pellet gun pointed it, maybe took a couple of shots at somebody. He was a disturbed individual. Of course, they're not going to blame Hollywood for a cosplay gone wrong, which is what it looks like to me. As the facts are starting to come in, this guy was a disturbed individual. It's still not certain that he's been committed four times. It's still not certain if that was recent or if it was as long ago as 2007. That'd be 8 years ago. Nevertheless, they're not going to blame Hollywood for inspiring this. They're not going to say that everybody freaked out and called the cops who then came in and started shooting when he pointed his gun. Perhaps he was mentally disturbed. He was homeless. If he pointed a pellet gun at a cop, the cop is justified to shoot him. But at that point, all pandemonium broke out and it was over. So we're going to talk about what happened with that. But there's a surprising article up from Panama. They said that they are going to open up gun imports into the country. This is what their public safety minister wants to do. He's taken a look at the statistics that we've been talking about here at InfoWars for quite some time, saying that the increased gun ownership has decreased crime. And he says, we got a crime wave here. We need to bring in more firearms. But at the same time, we have conservative Texas Senator Cornyn joining with the NRA, trying to increase background checks for people who are nuts, like this guy at the theater yesterday. You know, the right to keep and bear arms is a fundamental right, and you don't make it better by making it more difficult for the vast majority of people in a society who are sane to exercise that fundamental right. We're going to talk about that. We're going to talk about new revelations in Planned Parenthood. We're even going to talk about some health news. We haven't talked about health news the last couple of days. I've had a story about one guy's patent that would use mushrooms to replace Monsanto. Stay with us. We'll be right back. Alex Jones is going to be joining us at the bottom of the hour with a follow-up report to Operation Chaos. What is going on in Europe? And we're going to talk about that in some economic news in just one moment. We're also going to be joined by Jim Mars in the third hour to talk about his book, Population Control. We have an interesting video from congressional testimony talking about vaccines that we'll play for you before Jim Mars gets here as well. Of course, tonight is the first of the big debates. They had a debate on Monday night in New Hampshire. Wasn't very interesting. It showed just how stifled and boring it can become when the Republican National Party dictates the rules avoids any kind of debate because they don't want a discussion. They want a beauty contest. It's just, but tonight's going to be different. Tonight's going to be different. They're all concerned about what's going to happen when Donald Trump gets there and he doesn't play by the nice, polite rules that they've imposed on political discussion in this country. I think that's one of the big things, the passion that he has, and of course, his contempt for political correctness. I think we saw that with Jeremy Clarkson, Top Gear, in the UK, of course. That was what got him pushed out by the BBC, even though he had by far and away the largest program on the BBC, the most profitable aspect of the BBC, over 5 million viewers of each episode. It was huge for the BBC, but they pushed him out because he mocked and laughed at their political correctness. Of course, now he's going to have a program based in the United States on Amazon. I think that's what is really appealing to most people about Donald Trump, is the frankness to not shy away from these issues, and really a passion that you can see in the debates in the British Parliament that we don't have here. We have people stand up and read prepared speeches. And it's not because they can't think. It's because most of them have imposed upon them by the leadership these rules of politeness. We saw how they pushed back. Orrin Hatch, Mitch McConnell, and others pushed back and censored Ted Cruz. I don't think censored is the official. That's an official action. They didn't do that, but they called him out on the floor of the Senate because he pointed out that Mitch McConnell had lied when he was pushing through the Trans-Pacific Partnership. He was concerned about the Export-Import Bank, Ted Cruz was. He wasn't concerned about the secretiveness of the Trans-Pacific Partnership or the Transatlantic Partnership. He wasn't concerned about turning over all of the responsibilities of our legislature to pass laws. He wasn't concerned about the transnational governance aspect of it. He was concerned about the Export-Import Bank and other things like that that I think were trivial. And of course, he voted for it the first time through. He knew that it wasn't going to, he had the ability to vote against it the second time. So I think that his second vote was purely political. We're also going to talk about what's going on with the shooting at the theater yesterday. And I want to do that right now. You know, this is a situation where we see a guy go into a movie, Mad Max. He's dressed up in costume. He's got a little toy axe. He's got a pellet gun. He probably looked pretty crazy as well. Initial reports said he was 51, then 47, then now they're settled on, I think, 29 is his age. He's somebody who has a history of mental illness. He's been committed 4 times. I've seen various reports. Some of them said that it was within the last year. Some of them said that it's been as long ago as 2007. Nevertheless, what this looks like to me is somebody who's probably a little bit mentally deranged. He's homeless. He's got the money to go to this movie. He gets into this cosplay thing. And because he's got a pellet gun, he points it at a cop. When the shooting starts, he pulls out some pepper spray, and then all pandemonium breaks out. Everybody believes they're under attack. Nobody was hurt in this, except for this guy, and he was shot dead by the cops. Here's how the story breaks down. They say that he entered with pepper spray and airsoft pellet gun. It's not even a real pellet gun. Airsoft, if you don't know, are little plastic, like BBs. They have absolutely no mass. You can shoot that at close range with each other. My boys used to play with airsoft all the time. And an axe. Now, the axe, if you've seen a picture of the axe, you know it doesn't have an edge on it either. So he goes in, dressed up for Mad Max. Theatergoers and the audience, something happens, and they were concerned about it. They ran out. They alerted police officers who were responding to a vehicle crash nearby. And I don't know, but I'm looking at this and thinking, you know, they might have just seen this guy and been concerned that he was going to do something because they saw an airsoft pistol in his pocket, and he's dressed kind of weird in cosplay. And they might have gone out and pulled the cops in. And then at that point, when the cop enters, he points his pellet gun at the officer and pulls the trigger, shooting a massless little plastic bubble at him. The cop then fired one round from his patrol rifle in self-defense and backed out and got the SWAT team. At that point, Montano, the guy who the perpetrator, began to use the pepper spray. Officers said they encountered a cloud of pepper spray when they entered to take him into custody. He attempted to run out of the back door of the theater, and as he emerged with his toy axe in his hand and started toward the officers, 5 of them opened fire and killed him. Now, here's what happened in the theater. One man was cut on the shoulder. It was minor, evidently brushed against the axe the guy was carrying, they say. His wife, and his daughter were treated for pepper spray. And in this particular article by AP, they say that he was committed twice in 2004, twice in 2007. Now, who's to blame? It's a tragedy. I think it was overreaction by some people in the theater that got the police to come in there. When he points the airsoft pistol at him, then that's it. They think they've got a live shooter. And at that point, this mentally disturbed man, and it is mentally disturbed to point a pistol at a cop today, and even if it's a toy gun, you know you're going to get killed. That's the way they roll today. Nevertheless, who's to blame? Is it Hollywood? No, Hollywood's not getting any criticism for inspiring somebody to dress up with a toy pistol and an axe and go watch the movie. I've seen this kind of stuff since the 1980s. I remember when the first Conan the Barbarian movie came out with Arnold Schwarzenegger, we made the mistake of going to see it, and there were all these people dressed up in these Conan outfits. It's the first time I'd seen any kind of cosplay like that. But nevertheless, is Hollywood to blame? No. Are we going to blame the hatchet? No. Are we going to blame the pepper spray? No. Are we going to blame the airsoft gun? Yes. Yes, we will blame that. We will not blame the psychiatric evaluation. We will blame the airsoft gun. But we will take a look at the psychiatric evaluations, and maybe we'll have our conservative Texas senator, Senator John Cornyn, join with the NRA to say we need to have more background checks and information. Don't worry. It won't be a requirement. We'll just offer incentives to states to reward them on snooping on everybody. Look, it's not a case of people like this guy who went to the movie theater. It's really more, and we've seen this over and over again. They are targeting, they're angling to go after the veterans to take away their guns. They want to make everybody look like they're a lunatic. They want to find some justification to take away the veterans' guns. They want to find a justification to take away people's guns who are on Social Security by merely saying if you have an automatic deposit of your check, that means that you're financially incompetent. Therefore, you're not competent to own a gun. That's the kind of logic. And now we see the NRA and Senator John Cornyn from Texas pushing to do more federal background checks. Listen. Second Amendment says our fundamental human rights shall not be infringed. And that includes infringement by the NRA by conservative so-called senators. On the other hand, look at what Panama is doing. Panama is lifting a ban on gun imports amidst a rising crime wave. They say more firearms will mean fewer homicides. That's their public safety minister, Aguilera. This is what he says. He says, everything seems to indicate that there's no direct correlation in the aphorism that says more guns mean more crime. He said that relaxed gun laws have allowed the United States to reduce the homicide rate over the last 20 years. That's what we've been telling people. That's what the FBI has been telling people. You can look at the figures and you can understand that. Look at the data. You can see the trend happening. Less gun laws, more ownership in an area. It's not only nationally, but it is region by region. Where do you have the most shootings in the gun-free areas? Where do you have the most killings in the areas like Chicago where they try to control guns? They can't control guns. It's a means of people control. They say under current law, in effect since 2012, only Panama State Security Forces can import firearms. Now, on the other side, we have this organization, SICA's Central American Program of Small Arms Control. Does that sound like something from the UN? Yeah, because that's their agenda that they're doing. And the person who works for them, the director of that organization, says, it's a decision for each sovereign government to make, but we would take into account that for criminals, anything that's prohibited becomes more attractive. Yeah, that's true. That's one of the reasons why prohibition doesn't work. They go on to say, there is no registry of firearms that come in, much less exact data of how many we have. This is another minister of the Panamanian government. He says illegal weapons trafficking does not generate as much profit as drugs, but it does threaten citizen security. So let me ask him, how well is that prohibition doing at stopping the flow of drugs or stopping the flow of guns? See, prohibition in a black market like that, where people know that they need something and they do know that they need to be able to protect themselves. But when they want something like drugs or they want something like alcohol, prohibition simply makes things more lethal. We've seen that. It adds to corruption. We've seen that. and it doesn't stop it. We've seen that. And so it's not stopping there. Last thing on this story, he says, in 2012, the United Nations Office on Drugs and Crime estimated that an average of 700,000 firearms circulated through Panama's streets. Now, understand, that is where this is all coming from. This is all coming from the UN. That's their agenda, to try to stop all small firearms, to try to do worldwide gun control by stopping the flow of arms across borders. That's what the UN Arms Trade Treaty is about. That's what they've been feeding this with, and that's why they were doing Fast and Furious. They wanted to make a case to push the UN Arms Trade Treaty through. Of course, John Kerry signed it anyway, but it is still not in effect. We'll see what they do. They don't necessarily need to have a law, and we'll talk about that when we come back. Stay with us. We're going to have a special report in the next section, a follow-up from Alex's report on Operation Chaos. And of course, Alex Jones is in Europe investigating the globalist takeover that is happening there. We're going to talk about a couple of different aspects of that in this section of the broadcast. We're going to talk about some economics as well as the immigration issue. And of course, that's a key part of what he was talking about with Operation Chaos. Before we get back to the news, however, I just want to let you know that we have a new flash sale today. We have a 24-hour sale. We've been doing this last several days. This is a 24-hour sale on OccuPower. Today, we're offering 30% off of OccuPower. That'll last for 24 hours. Again, OccuPower is specifically designed to nutritionally assist the natural function of healthy eyes. I've done reports in the past for a group called AMD. They work with age-related macular degeneration. Your eyes are constantly replacing the cells in your retina. It's one of the places where nutrition is so incredibly important. And one of the few things that they found that really does help to control and to prevent age-related macular degeneration, which begins with a blind spot in the center of your eye and then gets worse and worse, and it can get worse very rapidly. The only thing they found that really works for that is nutrition. I have an aunt who is still alive. She's 91, and I remember years ago she started having macular degeneration. It was early stages of it. She started taking a lot of nutrients that were designed specifically to for the eye, and it basically reversed itself for her. She's now 91, and she just stopped driving, not necessarily because of her eyes, but because of other things. Again, with OccuPower, it has essential natural nutrients, things like ataxanthin, lutein, and eyebright herb to give you the support you need for nutrition of your retina, nutrition of your eye to prevent that kind of age-related disease. Again, you can get that for the next 24 hours, 30% off, and our free shipping has been extended for this week. As we point out, the July free shipping, we extended it for one more week as a thank you. It will not be extended again. And you can use that for anything at InfoWarsLife.com. All of our products that are there, you can get that with free shipping. Now, getting back to the news, I pointed out Alex is going to be having a report from Italy, a follow-up to Operation Chaos. We're going to have that in the next section. Today, this news, a Euro group of bankers is calling for economic government, quote-unquote. This is on InfoWars.com. They say they want more taxes levied on citizens. But really what they're doing is they're trying to use these economic situations, the economic collapse, the indebtedness of Greece and other countries, they're using that to push for greater control, greater sovereignty. And we've seen Greenspan, Alan Greenspan, former head of the Federal Reserve, say the only way that you're going to solve this crisis in Greece and the other countries that are lined up to have this crisis is to surrender sovereignty. We saw the head of PIMCO, the largest bond company, say the same thing. And now we have Francois Hollande, France's socialist president, calling for a separate economic government to lord over the monetary union, as reported by Der Spiegel. And what they're saying is that it's not only him, of course. Now we have the French prime minister saying that. Now we have another big money man, globalist George Soros, saying that it is crucial that the European Union have a centralized authority. We have told you all along, this is the way this thing rolls, just like we're going to see with the Transatlantic and Trans-Pacific Partnership. They will create free trade zones. Then they will move to a greater economic union. Then they will have an economic crisis because of the socialism and the welfare state policies that they've created and debt the people to where they cannot pay for it anymore. Then they're going to say, well, we the bankers now have to take control over you irresponsible people. That's precisely how this is all working out. And we can see this plan falling into place, as we've been telling you for a very long time here at InfoWars. Another article up on InfoWars.com. TPP leaks show us that the U.S. stands firm that companies should be free to abuse patents and copyrights. This is from TechDirt, and they point out that earlier reports had suggested that everyone was just weeks away from finishing the TPP and the TTIP. Many had said that the only thing holding back a final agreement was fast-tracked authority from the U.S. Now, that's been put through, and I noticed when they were putting that through, they have a lot of different conditions on it in terms of it cannot be stopped. It doesn't need a recommendation out of committee. It doesn't need a recommendation from the leader. If it doesn't go to the House floor within a short period of time, it will automatically go to the House floor, to the Senate floor. At that point, there will be no more debate than 20 hours. The Senate cannot filibuster it. But one of the interesting things, and of course, no amendments, One of the things that was interesting was that they were saying that this agreement had to be, this was something that had to be negotiated after the TPA. And of course, they've been working on this thing for years. And I thought, well, how are they going to work this out? Well, they're just kind of delaying it. But the latest proposals show that they want to have a system that is anti-competitive, abusive, they say, because when the Australians said, we're going to take away patents that can be characterized that way, they said, no, we're not. They opposed it in the U.S. Stay with us. We'll be right back.
On yesterday's syndicated radio/TV transmission, I broke down a detailed report on what I dubbed Operation Chaos, how all over the Western world, the elites are encouraging illegal populations to flood in with the promise of free welfare, free health care, have your babies for free, everything else. We talked about cities in California, like Huntington Park, that is appointing to key commissions illegal aliens to run major city departments who don't even have their credentials on top of the fact that they're breaking the law. This is sedition. This is treason by the ultra elite with the outnumbering giant third world populations. And if you look at the parallels with Rome, Caesars, Roman emperors later towards the decline would actually bring in mercenary armies and mercenary worker groups to displace and control politically Romans. That ended up bringing down Rome. And now in Italy, in France, in the UK, in Greece especially, we showed you the New York Times article yesterday, it is a full-scale, again, what was the term that was used? Full-scale disaster, the New York Times said. While they promote the policies of all this free welfare that helps cause this and not deporting the lion's share of these people. The world is collapsing. This is only going to get worse, but the globalists will always offer their solution, giving them more taxes, more power, more police state control, which they then don't even use to secure the borders, the wealth, and the sovereignty. We need the West to stay incredibly wealthy, powerful, innovative, and then transfer technology to the third world and build tourist destinations and economic development zone destinations inside third world nations to build them up. Now, that's the public promotion for 60 years of globalism. They said that, and it made sense, but they haven't delivered. Instead, it's about keeping them poor. It's about exploiting them. It's about deindustrializing them. It's about sowing destabilization. This has all been declassified. That's why they fund ISIS to run around the whole Middle East. And now, if Syria dares fight back against ISIS, that's being immigrated in by the globalists, they're going to bomb them starting next week. War has been declared against Syria unofficially. That just shows you the order out of chaos mentality. But Rob Dew was able to get footage, and so was I, of just hordes of illegals just sitting around doing nothing, collecting their welfare checks all over Rome. I was able to get a demonstration basically against the open borders and other issues and what's happening economically on tape as well. So we're going to roll some of that footage here in a moment, and I'm going to be basically narrating over it. But I know you as a listener and a viewer already understand these basics. We've got to get the word out to other people. But this isn't about being nice to the third world that we're doing this. This is being done to economically drive down wages. This is being done to make us poor, all of us, so we can be more politically managed. This is the admitted plan. And it's a revolution where you get the book thrown at you if you're a Hispanic American, a Black American, a White American, an unhyphenated American. If you're an American, you get screwed over. You're known as a chump. But the illegals are above the law and can now be on the city council, just be appointed. It's wrong. It's discriminatory. And no one else puts up with this. Basically, our political immune system has been removed. America and the West has its shields completely down and are being subdivided, are having any original cultures erased and destroyed. So this whole plastic, artificial matrix-like system of control can be overlaid over it. And that's really the story here. They say Rome is collapsing economically and falling apart and rotting outside the tourist areas. We've been out there and seen it for ourselves. It's not just Rome is collapsing. It's all of America. It's all of Europe. It's all of the West, because we've been sold out by political interests that want us poor, that want us dumb, because they have diplomatic immunity. They have governmental and corporate reservations that are above the law and exempt from everything they're doing that are safe. And as long as the elites don't have to abide by the same laws, don't have to pay the same taxes, don't have to drink the same water, we're screwed. I mean, it's in the news for a decade that the Chinese elite, the German elite, the British elite, the U.S. elite, the Japanese elite don't take vaccines, or they get special secret lots that are, quote, safe and clean. They don't drink fluoride water. They don't eat GMO. They have the secret gardens all over the world. It's even come out in mainstream news where they are producing, for the Chinese elite and others, clean food. The New World Order is like 100 Manhattan projects, using our money, our ingenuity, compartmentalized, to set up a whole new world for the establishment, an Elysium for the demigods that they want to become. And then we get nothing. Only by admitting what's going on outside of the controlled matrix-like media, only by getting outside the bread and circuses of the modern Circus Maximuses and the modern Colosseums, only by getting outside of that will we regain our humanity and the mystery and the majesty that is the universe all around us. That's how we transcend these people, is realizing there's a whole world of mystery and a universe of mystery around us, but the globalists are no mystery. I mean, I talk about Manhattan projects, 100,000+ people involved for 4 or 5 years, kept it secret, no problem until they wanted to admit the A-bomb production out in New Mexico and other areas. I've known since I got on air 20 years ago, I was told by high-level pro-lifers and others, and saw documents and lawsuits that were going on, how they were vivisecting and keeping babies alive and selling their parts. And now it's in the news. People say, oh, so what, kill babies? Well, you know what, so what, kill you? You know what, so what, harvest you? You know what, go ahead and kill veterans. Go ahead and kill old people. They'll kill you too, you dumb punks. You don't have any empathy and you don't demand standards. You don't stand up for other people getting screwed over. You're going to get screwed over. Everything the New World Order does is pure death. And it's not going to help the poor people fleeing collapsing Middle East and fleeing collapsing Africa and everywhere else. You got to fix the New World Order that's screwing these countries over. You got to stop globalism that's meant to create a cascade of global crises that bring in total world domination, a world cashless society, a total control grid. I'm going to throw it back to David Knight and the InfoWars crew, doing a fabulous job in Austin, Texas. Today, we're going out to talk about the Vatican, to research sites around Rome and the Vatican, and bring you a lot of key info, because the globalists are making their move. Obama calling for world government, the Pope calling for world government, carbon taxes. They've gone from this doesn't exist to the emerger point where they decloak to fire. We've always said for over a decade, and all the experts have agreed, that when they start admitting all this stuff out in the open, while they denied it behind the scenes, we're in deep trouble. But it's an opportunity, because finally, folks, we can say, see, we told you, we wrote books, we made films, exactly as we said now happening, here's the documents, don't live in denial, we can do something, we can say no, we can withdraw our consent, we can vote with our dollars. It's an epic time to be alive. And in my gut, I knew that traveling to Europe to investigate this for myself was key. I've been here a long time ago, but hadn't been to this area in a long time other than the UK. We're here now. And I'm going to be traveling more, a few times a year at least, to Asia and to Africa and to Latin America, so we can firsthand really get down in the weeds and break down exactly what's happening. So I'm about to go out. It's in the morning here. I'm about to go out, and we're just going to shoot tons of footage, interview people, see what we see. We've already run into demonstrations. We've already run into just all sorts of stuff. And this is what it's all about, true journalism, where we wear the truth on our sleeve, our bias to be honorable, where we're open about it, where we don't follow talking points. We follow history, our hearts, and the good conscience that the good Lord gave us. Alex Jones signing off for InfoWars.com from Rome, Italy.
And again, that's Alex Jones reporting on the globalist takeover in Europe. And as we mentioned in the last segment, a story up on InfoWars.com, Eurogroup bankers call for, quote, economic government, unquote. More taxes levied on citizen proposal floated despite longstanding taboo against EU-wide taxation. See, they came in and said it's just going to be a trading zone. It was going to be a free trade zone, the European Union. It was going to lift everybody's economies up because they were going to remove the trade sanctions, let people move freely back and forth between the borders within Europe. And now what we see happening is we see a massive immigration from other areas outside of Europe. We now see that they've taken the socialist welfare states that the bankers have encouraged, said, you are now so far in debt to us that we're going to have to take over, take your assets, seize your assets, as they're doing in Greece, and seize your sovereignty. That's precisely what they're doing. I'm going to go back and cover some more economic news, because the other aspect of this, of course, is the Trans-Pacific Partnership. And I didn't have time to get into that article before we went to break. Before I do, I just want to let you know that we still have free shipping this week. Everything at InfoWarsLife.com is available with free shipping. We have Survival Shield X2. That's our nascent iodine. X2 has over 400 reviews on InfoWarsLife.com. Over 99% of the respondents would recommend it to a friend or family member. Let me read you one of those responses right now. This is from Gex611, Toronto, Canada. He says, I love this product. Alex Jones knows what he's doing. I'm glad he's helping many people. This is the right way to do so. Give them something that works fast, that's easy to use, priced fairly, and the results will show for itself. It's a win-win for us all. Exactly. That's why we do this. That's why we support our operation this way. We have to support it somehow. We could do it with donations. We could get government grants, presumably, I guess, from MSNBC. I don't think the government would give us any money. But we appreciate your support. That's one of the reasons we have done it this way. We want to help people to do something about their health, because if you don't have your health, you can't fight the fight for liberty, for individual liberty. So we offer these products, and we appreciate those people who support us. That's why we've extended this for another week. And we also have, just briefly, a flash sale on OccuPower. This is a 24-hour sale. You can get 30% off of OccuPower. It's a high nutritional supplement to support your body's eyesight. The retina is constantly replacing cells. You need a lot of good nutrition in order to keep that happening. And so we support that with this natural nutritional ingredients that you'll find in OccuPower, things that are targeted towards that. Again, 30% off OccuPower for the next 24 hours. Everything free shipping just through the end of this week. Now, as we're reporting just before we went to the break, there's another leak of some information from the secretive TPP and TTIP, the Transatlantic Trans-Pacific Partnership Agreements, that we're not allowed to see. They're being created by the corporate lobbyists, and we can't see those. Although we have had Senator Sessions and a few others go to look at it. Senator Sessions says this is something we should all be very concerned about, because it is not free trade. This is about creating a global governance committee that we have no say-so as to who goes there, just as we don't have any say-so about what goes into these treaties. And the treaty itself, once it's passed by the Congress without amendment, once that is passed, then it will be infinitely amendable by this transnational governance, this committee that will be set up. How does that work? Well, it's going to be a living document, just as the liberals like to pretend the Constitution is a living document. That's the way they get it to be a liberal document, by saying it is living. These are the folks at KEI. They've started releasing a leaked copy of the intellectual property chapter. This is one of the key things that lets us know that this is, besides the international governance, besides the elevation of corporations to the level of governments with this arbitration process that people have talked about, state investor arbitration court, besides all of those clues, we know that this is not about free trade because of things like the intellectual property chapter. As it stood on May 11th, and that was the latest draft prior to the meeting that they had last week, they say, in countless ways, the Obama administration has sought to expand and extend drug monopolies in order to raise prices. The astonishing collection of proposals pandering to big drug companies make more difficult the task of ensuring access to drugs for the treatment of cancer and other diseases and conditions. They say there's widely reported dispute over the number of years of protection for biologic drug test data. But they say this agreement, when they're summarizing what's in there, they say this focuses more on intellectual property rights for drug companies and a death-inducing spiral of higher prices and barriers to access. So one of the countries involved, Australia, put out a proposal. They said, well, countries should be able to cancel, revoke, or nullify a patent if, quote, the patent is used in a manner determined to be anti-competitive or abusive by a judicial or administrative proceeding. Well, that sounds reasonable, doesn't it? If somebody is using their patent in an anti-competitive or abusive way, and they've extended it for an extremely long time, then we ought to be able to take that patent away. But the U.S. opposes that, as well as Japan. Somebody should tell the Aussies that that's the whole point of the secret trade agreement, is to extend monopoly control for these people who are writing the agreement in secret. It's not about free trade, folks. We can have this agreement, this argument between free trade and jobs and so forth. We can have that argument, but that's not what this is about. This goes far beyond that. It's about global governance. We've seen the Trilateral Commission even set up to talk about how there would be three different blocks, and then we would combine those three blocks together into a global governance. Those three blocks are, surprisingly, North America, Europe, and Asia. How are these treaties operating? Well, that's precisely what they're creating. Let's look at the way this is working out. We've talked a lot about Greece. We've talked some about Venezuela. Now we see not only has Venezuela given a 700% return on investment to the bankers. They bragged about that. We've talked about that many times, how they would get a 700% return on investment, according to Bloomberg. It was a great investment to invest with the socialists like Hugo Chavez in Venezuela, because they knew that they needed to pay the bankers first. It took priority even over their own people, getting food, water, and medicine. Now we see Venezuela's inflation is going to 800%. So see how that works? First, you create a welfare state and you go into debt to the bankers. You pay them first. They make a 700% return on investment. The people are starving, can't get food and water, can't get medicine. And then your currency goes into hyperinflation. That's a pattern for enslavement. And that's precisely what they're trying to feed the people in Europe right now when they say that they need to have economic governance. They need to surrender sovereignty to the center. And we see Alan Greenspan, George Soros, PIMCO, all saying, yes, the only way this is going to work is for people to surrender their sovereignty. So now we see the latest indication that things are, that socialism doesn't work. Venezuela's inflation goes to 800%. Now, there was an interesting article that we had. I think it was Infowars.com had this, but it's originally from the Mises Institute. And they were talking about Greece's reliance on public funds being the central problem. As we've said many times, it's not that the Greek people are not working hard. When you look at it, they put in an average annual work hours by country. When that's sorted, we see that Greece is second only to Mexico in terms of the average number of hours worked. So they're very hard working. They put in more hours on average than people in the United States do. But the problem comes when you flip it to the next graph and you see the percentage of the population reliant on public funding, a measure of socialism. We see that the U.S. is around 40%, just over 40% of the population reliant on public funding. And of course, that doesn't include the people who work for the government, unfortunately. So that would put us much, much higher. But just on this yardstick alone, we see that Greece is up to over 60%. That right there is what happens. Eventually, you run out of other people's money, as Margaret Thatcher said. And eventually, they run you out of your home. They seize the hard assets in your country, as they're doing in Greece, and then they dictate to you what your laws will be. Stay with us. We'll be right back. We have an article up on Infowars.com video. Berkeley students saying that the Chattanooga attack on soldiers was, quote-unquote, legitimate. They also saying that calling the shooter a Muslim is also racist. Well, he actually called himself a Muslim. He made it very clear that he was a jihadist and that he was deliberately targeting the military. But of course, I thought it was only the right-wingers who were supposedly hated the military, the Tea Party guys, and that sort of thing. But we see that these people want to put this into a racist context. That's the insanity that we see coming into this country, where everything is put into a racist context. just as we saw the video that Mark Dice had where he was asking people about the Bill of Rights. And he talked to a black man and he goes, I think it's kind of racist, the Bill of Rights. So yeah, if Hillary wants to get rid of it, I'm sure it's because it's racist. And he goes, well, what percentage would be racist? Well, I don't know, maybe about 30%, 30% racist. So we ought to get rid of it. So what he doesn't realize is that it protects his rights as an individual. And if we stop seeing ourselves as individuals and start seeing ourselves solely as members of groups, then we are ripe to be manipulated for a civil war, for a race war, for political purposes. Take a look at this other article here we've got at Infowars.com, a Twitter bot to correct people who use the term illegal immigrants. Now, this is a couple of politically correct journalists with Fusion.net, a Disney ABC-owned media provider. They created a Twitter robot, a Twitter bot, that corrects people who use the term illegal immigrant. By Twitter bot, they mean that it is searching Twitter. Whenever it sees these terms, this program will automatically send a tweet to them, advising them to change their use of language. It was called Drop the I Bot. Drop the I Bot. Maybe they should just drop their bot. And actually, that's what Twitter did. Twitter suspended their account. But what they were doing was they would see somebody use the term illegal alien, and they would say, quote, people aren't illegal. Try saying undocumented immigrant or unauthorized immigrant instead. Well, actually, no, people are here illegally. That's the whole point. That's the whole point of the anger and the frustration that people have. The fact that it's not, they say it's dehumanizing to call somebody illegal, but it's dehumanizing for us to lose our equal protection under the law. We don't have equal protection under the law. They want to attract out of control immigration. They want to bring people in faster than we can absorb them socially or economically. And they're incentivizing this. And in order to do that, they're giving illegal immigrants as well as legal immigrants benefits that we as citizens don't even enjoy. Things like in-state tuition in every state. We can only get it in the state in which we live. They get it in every state. They have a catch and release program for illegal violent criminals. They're given essentially diplomatic immunity when they commit crime. So we want to see equal protection of the law. We would like to actually see some protection from our government instead of the government constantly attacking us. But of course, when we do that, we get hit with these politically correct robots, which is exactly what we see there. Zuckerberg is saying, another social site, not Twitter, but Facebook executive, says that the GOP's immigration stance will doom it. Well, you know, Boehner, McConnell, Paul Ryan, Scalise, the leadership, they really don't care. They really don't care whether they allow, they'll use rhetoric to get elected that says that they're going to do something about treating illegal and legal aliens better than they treat American citizens. They'll say that. And meanwhile, they will let that happen and not do anything to stop it because they could care less about the GOP brand. And you know what? You should care less about the GOP brand. It's just another grouping to control you, just like getting you controlled into black versus white, Republican versus Democrat. They don't care about destroying the GOP brand, and you shouldn't either. You should care about America. You should care about yourself and your family. The heck with the GOP. Stay with us. We'll be right back, and we're going to talk about this. Welcome back to the Alex Jones Show on this August 6, 2015. I'm David Knight, your host. Joining us in the next hour will be Jim Marrs, and we're going to talk about his recent book, Population on Population Control. There's many different aspects to population control, of course, and we're going to talk to him about that. So stay with us when we get back. He'll be with us in the third hour. I want to talk about the debate that's coming up. We've got the 70th anniversary of the bombing of Hiroshima. We're going to talk about that as well. In this segment, I want to cover some of the breaking news that's coming out. Of course, we were talking in the last segment about immigration and about the political correctness of many people who are trying to shut down the discussion on immigration, how the GOP, although it talks about it, doesn't do anything about it. That's the key thing that is behind the rise of Donald Trump, I believe. The fact that, and I hope it's true, I hope he would do something about it if he were elected. We've heard a lot of talk from the GOP in recent elections, and they don't do anything about Obamacare. They don't do anything about the open borders. And of course, I don't want to see a fence put up. I want to see them stop attracting people. They've worked very hard to draw people into this country by incentivizing immigration and by using it to lower their wage costs. Many corporations have done this. So we need to stop that on the basis of the corporations, and we need to stop the government from doing it. But they're not. Here's an article. Obama is providing extra one million alien work permits annually. They say the Obama administration has issued more than 7.4 million work permits to foreign nationals from 2009 to 2014. Beyond the approximately 1 million lawful permanent residents and 700,000 foreign guest workers admitted to the U.S. each year. They say the Obama administration has been approving work authorizations for immigrants beyond admission limits and for some categories of immigrants that Congress never intended to work in the United States. See, that's why they have a special visa program to bring in people that they cannot get. It was sold as something that they would use to bring in scientists or engineers who were experts in their field that they could not find in America. That particular visa program, however, has been used by Disney, even by Donald Trump's organization. Donald Trump's brought in 1,100 people on that visa program. We've seen in Disney that they brought in massive numbers of people from India. And in both of these cases, they weren't technical people, both in Trump's case as well as Disney's case. They were not technical, non-replaceable people. These were service businesses. In the case of Disney, they brought in these Indian immigrants, told the American workers to train their replacements. And they did it all under a program that was supposedly for people that we could not find here in America. So they just want cheaper labor, folks. And of course, the government has a different agenda. The government has an Operation Chaos agenda, as Alex was pointing out. It's not just in America, but it's also in Europe. We have a Home Secretary who said this is unsustainable. And her approach was to, guess what? Stop attracting people by lowering the subsidies that they were giving immigrants into Great Britain. That's how you stop it. You start to roll back the welfare state that we can't even afford for our own citizens, let alone for anyone who wants to come into this country with or without our permission and make themselves a dependent. It has to stop. We can't afford it. We can't do it. It's kind of like the situation when you're on an airplane and the masks were to descend. The first thing you're told is to put it on yourself before you try to put it on your children. Because if you pass out, nobody's going to help them. So you have to take care of the core first before you can help the people surrounding you. And there's a limit to the number of people, of course, that we can bring in. This report, too, should also concern you, because we also have this week the Black Hat Conference in Vegas and the DEF CON Conference. Here's a little $32 device that will allow anybody to duplicate what's on your wireless key fob to steal your car or to get into your garage. Very simple way to do it. It is so easy. As we become more and more reliant on these high-tech gadgets, we become more and more vulnerable to bad actors as well as to our government. Stay with us. We're going to talk about the debate. Tonight is the first of the real debates. Donald Trump will be there, and it'll be limited to 10. There will be a junior varsity debate earlier in the day for the people who are polling really, really low. People like Rick Perry, Rick Santorum, Lindsey Graham, Carly Fiorina, and somebody that I don't even remember their name. They're polling so low. So they're going to have that at earlier in the afternoon. And then, of course, the debate with 10 candidates is not really clear how much time any of these people are going to have or if there'll be anything of any substance. But everybody has hopes that there will be, because they believe that Donald Trump is not going to follow the staid formula that we saw on the debate on Monday night. Before we get to that, and I want to talk about that, I want to talk about the 70th anniversary of the bombing of Hiroshima from a different perspective, not from a military perspective, not even whether it was the right thing to do, but I want to put you on the ground level. There is a story from the Washington Post, so we're going to talk about that. And we're also going to talk about some revelations about the Planned Parenthood scandal. We now see some of the places where these baby parts are being used. Something you need to think about with that as well. Before we do, I just want to let you know that we have free shipping at the InfoWars Life store. We have extended that for one more week, but it is going to end the end of this week. It's going to end tomorrow. We extended it once from the month of July. We extended it for one more week because a lot of people are on vacation, traveling. I think a lot of people didn't realize we had free shipping. We didn't really talk about it that much until just the end of the month. So we extended it for one more week as a thank you. And everything that you get at InfoWarsLife.com has free shipping. We have in stock Survival Shield X2, our nascent iodine. There's over 400 reviews you can read there. Decide if this is right for you. Iodine is a vital nutrient that we all need. This is a very easy way to take it in liquid form. Here's a review from Steve from Texas. He says, I'm a healthy 58-year-old male, but this product has made me feel 20 years younger. I have great energy. My hearing and vision seem better, as well as my mental acuity. Again, you can look at the reviews at InfoWars.com. We also have a special on Silver Bullet, buy two, get two free. So that's 50% off of that. You get free shipping on anything that is at the InfoWarsLife.com site. So this is a good time to stock up on your preparedness products. Now, going to the election tonight, we've got a lot of anticipation tonight. They say, however, from the Hill that the election model predicts that Democrats will win. You can take this one with a grain of salt, folks. I've seen so many people jump into this and say, this is over, you have to support candidate so-and-so, or we're all doomed. Well, as I've said many times, I don't think one person is really going to change things. I'm for people who are going to open up the discussion. I'm for people who are going to focus us on issues that we haven't heard talked about, who are going to do it in a way that's going to engage the population in ways that are going to move us towards individual freedom. And I think that Donald Trump is going to open up the discussion. I think that Rand Paul is going to move us in ways that will impact our individual liberties. That's my personal feel on it. But of course, when we look at this, they want to scare everybody into thinking that the world is over unless we get our guy in as president. I've said many times, we need to start pushing as hard on jury nullification education and getting behind things like that as we do getting behind a particular candidate. That's where we can stop this tyranny, whether it's state laws or whether it's local laws from your city council or whether it is the federal government trying to impose something on you. If you're in a jury, you are there to judge the law and not just the facts. The judge will lie to you. He will tell you otherwise. But you need to understand that in most cases, it's explicitly stated in most state constitutions, the long history of trial by jury is founded on the principle that the jury is trying the law as well as the facts of the case. That has always been the case. But they will lie to you about it. They will penalize and disbar lawyers who talk to you about it. You need to stand up for your individual rights. If we only had one person out of 12 on every jury, that's an 8% solution, we would get this over with. We could stop many laws with state nullification. You can have more effect at the state level. Getting behind a good sheriff in your area, that's very important. Locally, get focused locally. Stop letting them redirect you to the places where you have the least effect, where you have the least power, and that is at the presidential race. Nevertheless, we're all going to talk about it, and I do believe that it is good to talk about if we can have an open discussion on some of these issues. But there are people like Moody's Analytics who want to tell you that they've already decided that the Democrat presidential nominee will capture 270 electoral votes. They've even got it down. 270 electoral votes in 2016, according to their model. Well, you know what? Garbage in, garbage out. That's what we always said in engineering about computer models. I don't bow down before computer models. It's one of the reasons why I take with a grain of salt so many of these pronouncements that are made about man-made global warming. I don't believe that there's global warming going on, and I certainly don't believe that the contributions of man far outweigh the contributions of solar activity. The seasons are not created by our cars. If we had, just think about this, if we had more of an effect on the climate than the sun does, we wouldn't have seasons anymore, would we? There you go. Okay, but Moody's is telling us that they've worked this out. They're going to do a prediction update each month going up to November 2016, and they say their most important economic variable in their model is income growth in the 2 years leading up to the election. Well, fine. So that's their handicapping in the horse race. Fox News moderators are looking at ways to keep the 10 candidates on their toes for tonight's debate. And Chris Wallace is saying, I don't think anybody knows, maybe he doesn't know, what you're going to get from Donald Trump. What makes it such compelling television is that sense of, at the very least, uncertainty, and at the very most, danger. Well, it's not really danger. Okay, it's only danger to the political elites, to the political correctness. I think we need to open up and have debates that are more like, we ought to have real debates instead of these little prepared speeches and these little time limits, and I don't think they're going to give very much time to anybody to talk. I think we ought to have real debates like they do in the House of Commons. My wife and I went to the UK a couple of times, and we would always take one day to go sit in the House of Commons and just watch the back and forth. If you haven't seen that, it's great to see people really get passionate about things and people having to talk without a teleprompter, without sitting there and reading a speech. That's why we do the news the way we do here, or the nightly news. We do it without a teleprompter. We do the radio without a teleprompter as well. And I think people want to see that in politics. They really want to know what you think. And they want to see ideas debated, not positions laid out that are carefully crafted and written into a script for them by their handlers. Okay, anybody can have a position. The question is, do you have principles that you believe? And that will come out in a real debate, what you truly believe, and if you, because you're going to have to defend it. Now, in other news, political news, we see that the Rand Paul Super PAC officials have been indicted on federal charges. This goes back 4 years to the Ron Paul campaign. Jesse Benton and John Tate, two top strategists to Ron Paul, to Rand Paul's father, in his presidential campaign, allegedly steered $73,000 to an Iowa state senator to convince him to endorse Ron Paul in the lead-up to the 2012 Iowa caucuses. Now, they point out that these are charges that have been around, long-simmering charges, they say, is how it's reported in CNN. They say it's been investigated by the FEC now for 4 years. It threatens to cast clouds over the campaign of his son on the eve of the Republican presidential debate, you think? Isn't that convenient timing? I mean, certainly I don't excuse what happened. They think that it was reasonable. They're still fighting this. I don't know what the justification is for it, but certainly this is what you see with elections. You always see some scandal erupt the night before the election, or you see something like this that is held for 4 years and then brought out the day of the debate. There may be something of substance to it, but certainly they have timed it to try to create a problem. Now, as they're pointing, another article that came out yesterday, and I think is very interesting, from Washington Post, talks about how Donald Trump talked politics with Bill Clinton weeks before launching his 2016 bid. And if you look at this article, you can see a picture of Donald Trump and his wife at the time laughing it up with Bill and Hillary, because this was from Trump's blue period. As I pointed out yesterday, just like Picasso, he's had a blue period, and then he's had a rose period, a red period. And if you go back and look at this, we've had pushback from PolitiFact and some other places that said, look, he's given far more money to Republicans than he has to Democrats. Well, yeah, he's given 2/3 of his money to Republicans and 1/3 to Democrats if you average it all together over 26 years. But if you look at the chart that was put up, you will see that up until 5 years ago, he gave more money to Democrats than he did to Republicans. 5 years ago, things changed. He started donating a lot more money and doing it exclusively to Republicans as a lead up to this. But this brings up questions as to how close they are. This was a picture that you see here with them laughing it up. That was in 2005. That was during his blue period. They say four Trump allies and one Clinton associate familiar with the exchange said that Clinton encouraged Trump's efforts to play a larger role in the Republican Party and offered his own views of the political landscape. And this was something that happened in May, just before Donald Trump. Yeah, there's the graph I was talking about. So you can see in previous years, it was mostly Democrat money. And a lot of it went to the Clintons. He gave them a great deal of money. And then the last 5 years, it's been exclusively Republican and much, much heavier investment. They say Clinton's personal office in New York confirmed the call occurred in late May, but an aide to Clinton said that the 2016 race was never specifically discussed, so forth and so on. But people with knowledge of the call in both camps said that it was one of many that Clinton and Trump have had over the years, whether about golf or about donations to the Clinton Foundation. But the call in May was considered to be especially sensitive, coming soon after Hillary had declared her own presidential run the month before and immediately before Donald Trump declared his. Now, an article from Tyler Durden at Zero Hedge says there's officially no difference between Jeb and Hillary. Their biggest donors are the same. That's true. And Hillary sees Jeb as her biggest competition. She's focused on him and not on Donald Trump. Interestingly enough, Donald Trump has given money to both of them. So what does that say about how rigged the political process is? Stay with us when we come back. We're going to talk about Hiroshima, what it was like on the ground, eyewitness reports. Jim Marrs is going to be joining us in the next hour. We're going to talk about his book on population control, the many different aspects of population control. I'm also going to take calls from you beginning in the next segment at the bottom of the hour. If you want to call in and talk about perhaps the debate that's coming up tonight, perhaps about what I'm about to talk about, which is the 70th anniversary of Hiroshima, or any other topic, you can call in at 800-259-9231. Again, that's 800-259-9231. We'll take calls in the next half hour, and then in the third hour of the show, we're going to be talking to Jim Mars, who will be joining us in studio. A couple of more quick notes about tonight. One of the interesting things is that, and we've seen this before in the past, that some GOP candidates might only be on TV for 5 minutes during the debate. I would say it's going to be less than that. As they're talking about in this news from CBS DC, they're saying that many of the candidates will get 12 minutes to make their case. Some may only have 5 minutes of face time. Alan Schroeder, debate expert, journalism professor at Northeastern University, said that some of the 10 candidates' speaking times may be so minuscule that it will be as if they weren't there at all. Exactly. We've seen that many times throughout this. Now, as I mentioned, there's a well-timed indictment against the former Paul campaign that I think they held this thing for 4 years, talking about campaign contributions to a state senator in Iowa. I've seen this before, but now they have made an issue of it on the day of the debate. Again, that looks very political. There's also a GOP neocon group that is going to be running massive ads, a super PAC, to attack Rand Paul over Iran. The same super PAC that launched attacks on Rand Paul's foreign policy positions is preparing to air ads in Iowa and New Hampshire after Thursday's GOP debate. And as they point out in the article, while neoconservatives and GOP hawks have attacked the senator's willingness to use diplomacy, Paul's opposition to the Iran deal has also drawn fire from his libertarian conservative base. Antiwar.com's Justin Raimondo wrote an op-ed piece calling him a fraud, a failure, and a liar. So there you go. That's the way it goes. We all have to have perfect candidates. There isn't any perfect candidate out there. If you don't want to go to war and drop the bomb, the neocons are going to put their super PAC on you. And if you don't think that it's not a good deal, then you're going to be attacked by many in the libertarian base. So make up your own mind. But I think it's interesting to have Paul in the debate because I think he's going to bring up things from a different perspective. And one of the things that we need to think about when we become so cavalier about war, when we have these super PACs that are attacking anyone who merely looks as if they don't support every war everywhere, all the time, as we're seeing by both the Democrats and the Republicans. So many people voted for Obama because they thought he was going to stop wars. He has multiplied wars. He's now involved in a war in Syria where nobody is questioning him in the mainstream media or the political press. They're not questioning the legality of this except for one reporter from RT. Isn't that amazing? A reporter from RT. I don't even know if she's an American citizen. She's here covering in America, but she hammered him on the legality of it. What's the basis for you becoming the air support for Al-Qaeda? Never could get an answer from him. There is no basis for them doing this. Everybody should be questioning this, but no one is. Let's think about what happened 70 years ago. There's a report at Washington Post, what it was like to survive the atomic bombing of Hiroshima. And we need to think about this in terms of weapons that are on their way. Things like directed energy weapons, things like swarms of autonomous killer robots and drones, augmented human overlords, things that have been put in Pentagon documents that were just released. It'll be 2 weeks ago on Friday. We talked about this on the nightly news. The military, especially the Pentagon, especially DARPA, seems to have no limit to what they want to do. And I think when we go back and we look at what happened in Hiroshima, it provides some insights. Many people have said, why didn't they drop it somewhere as a show of force? They could have dropped it in Tokyo Bay, some other place, instead of a population center. That's a question. But let's put those questions of efficacy aside. Certainly, there would have been a lot of people, we all understand, that the war would have continued on. A lot of people on both sides would have died. But this is what it was like to be at the epicenter of this. One person said, my forehead felt hot. I unconsciously touched it with my hand. When I looked at the sky over Hiroshima, I saw a tiny, glittering white object about the size of a grain of rice tinged with yellow and red, which soon grew into a monstrous fireball. It was traveling in my direction. I felt as though it was going to envelop me. And when we come back, I'm going to read what it was like to be enveloped by that. And I want you to think about this when you watch these candidates tonight press relentlessly for more military engagements and a bigger defense department. Stay with us. We'll be right back. We're going to go to your calls in just one moment. I want to continue with what I began just as we were running out of time about Hiroshima. Before I get back to that, real quickly, we're having a flash sale today, a 24-hour sale of OccuPower. 30% off. You'll find that at InfoWarsLife.com. It's a way to support your eye health. The cells in your retina are constantly dying and being replaced. You need to have a good source of nutrition to support that replacement. OccuPower combines key ingredients like ataxanthin, lutein, and eyebright herb extract to give you the support that you need. And you can get that for 30% off right now at InfoWarsLife.com. We have free shipping through this week. We extended it one more week after the free shipping for July as a thank you, and that is going to end tomorrow. So that is something you can get, and it's not going to be extended again. Free shipping for everything at InfoWarsLife.com and a flash sale, 30% off of OccuPower for the next 24 hours. Now, today, of course, is the 70th anniversary of the use of the nuclear bomb against Hiroshima, the first time it was used. And I just want to focus, without getting on the issues, as I said before, of whether it could have been done a different way or different alternatives. I just want to focus on what it was like for the people who were there. This is a story from Washington Post, eyewitnesses. To continue with what this lady said, first she saw this spot like a grain of rice coming out to envelop her. And she said, what I felt at that moment was that Hiroshima was entirely covered with only three colors. I remember red, black, brown, but nothing else. Many people on the street were killed almost instantly. The fingertips of those dead bodies caught fire, and the fire gradually spread over their entire bodies from their fingers. A light gray liquid dripped down their hands, scorching their fingers. I felt the city of Hiroshima had disappeared all of a sudden. Then I looked at myself, and I found my clothes had turned into rags due to the heat. I was probably burned at the back of my head, on my back, on both arms and both legs. My skin was peeling and hanging like this. There were shadowy forms of people, some of whom looked like walking ghosts. Others moved as though in pain, like scarecrows, their arms held out from their bodies with forearms and hands dangling. These people puzzled me until I suddenly realized they had been burned, and they were holding their arms out to prevent the painful friction of raw surfaces rubbing together. Then they talk about a 21-year-old who was carrying her 1-year-old infant and her son in a streetcar. He died, she said, I think fragments of glass had pierced his head. His face was a mess because of the blood flowing from his head. But he looked at my face and smiled. And his smile has been glued in my memory. Simply collateral damage in military terms. This is what we create. The military-industrial complex has become the most profitable aspect, the thing that America will be remembered for. We have a military budget that is more than half of the entire federal budget. We have a military that is larger than all the other militaries combined. But we need more, because there's never enough. The military-industrial complex is like a greedy billionaire, like David Rockefeller, who said, or John D. Rockefeller, who said, when asked how much is enough, he said, just a little bit more. That's what we see. And I got to say to you that tonight, you're not going to see many people push back on this idea. Perhaps you'll see Rand Paul push back on it, and he'll get hammered by a super PAC for saying that we shouldn't extend this exponentially faster. He still wants to grow the military-industrial complex, but not at a fast enough rate for the rest of the people in the GOP, or for the people in the Democrat Party, for that matter. You think you're going to get peace by voting for Hillary Clinton? Are you kidding me? I mean, this is the party that gave us Madeleine Albright, who said about Iraq when she was asked about all the children who had died just from their sanctions. They said 500,000 children have died. Is it worth it? So it's worth it. We have our objectives. They could care less about innocent life. And when you look at what's going on with this, let me read you one of the last quotes on this article. One of the people who survived said, "I learned that nuclear weapons, which gnaw the minds and bodies of human beings, should never be used." But we're in the process, under our Democrat leader, of ramping up this Cold War that had ended. So now we're right at the threshold of Russia. We've fomented revolutions on the border of Russia. We have positioned our troops at Russia. We have revived the Cold War for the benefit of the military-industrial complex. And people like Lindsey Graham, they're still not satisfied. They want more. They want a war there. They want a war in Syria. They want a war in Iraq again. They're not satisfied. It's not enough killing. It's not enough weapons. And when you look at what the Pentagon sees as our military position in 30 years, it is absolutely amazing to even contemplate what they're doing. Just looking at their battlefield scenario, as I mentioned before, augmented human overlords controlling killer robots, many of them operating autonomously, directed energy weapons, things like you see in Star Wars, force fields, all of this sort of thing. Of course, they think that this is all going to be happening in the city. That's part of their scenario that we really didn't talk about. But that doesn't even include the other weapons, not just the nuclear weapons, but the bioterror weapons. The CDC and the Pentagon are bringing in and handling in a very careless and cavalier manner some of the most deadly pathogens that they can find, calling them select agents, and then using gain-of-function experiments to try to make them deadlier, more easy to catch, and creating more fatalities. What's going to happen when that gets loose? What's going to happen when artificial intelligence gets loose or the nanotechnology gets loose? And yet we race to do even more through DARPA. They can never have enough. That's what you need to keep in the back of your mind as you watch this debate tonight. Is there ever a point at which the Republicans would say that they have spied on us, controlled us, and created enough killing machines that it's enough? At what point? Do they have to have 90% of the armies in the world? 95%, 99%? Do they have to have absolute and total control over everyone? Perhaps that's what they're actually aiming for. It's no longer about defense. It's about mass murder. It's about destroying the human race. That's what we're racing to in this arms race. Let's go to your calls. Sherry in Texas, you said you wanted to talk about Donald Trump. Go ahead.
Donald Trump, but also something about socialism. This isn't meant to be like pro-Donald, although I think he's very is entertaining, and he's got some good points. It's just sort of a non-biased look here. Trump's donations and civility to Democrats, he explained on a Sunday morning show this last weekend, had to do with his business. And he said he couldn't accomplish what he wanted to accomplish business-wise, and this was not political. This was in a response to a question. He said, yes, I really did. I really was pro these politicians on both sides of the aisle. And it wasn't political. It was without any disrespect. There were donations. And he said when he's president, he'll be focusing on the people, not his business. If he can, in fact, shift that mindset onto the people, it would be great, because he said he did and said a lot of things, but it was for, I thought it was a good answer to the question, why, if you're running for as a Republican, if you want to represent the Republican Party, did you do so much sucking up to the Democrats? He said, this, because I'm a businessman. So that's about Donald, and I thought that was a good point.
Yeah, that's the problem I have with him, is that he's a crony capitalist businessman. He was sucking up to these people to get special favors. I mean, you know, we complain about people who control the political process, and we say these politicians are bought off by the corporations. And then we say, well, here's one of the corporations, one of the wealthy individuals who bought off the politicians, so let's put him in charge. I mean, the whole process is corruption. This is a guy who went into Connecticut, and he was going to drive at least five other smaller businesses out of business, doing a deal with the government so that he could put in his business. I don't like that. I don't like that kind of crony capitalism. I call that bully capitalism. He bullied an old lady because she didn't want to sell her house to him so he could put up so he could expand his parking lot. And so he went to the Casino Gaming Commission and got them to condemn her property and pay her a quarter of what he was going to pay her. That's bully capitalism. I don't see that as something that excuses it. I see that as even more damning as an excuse. What do you think, Sherry? You think that's okay?
Well, I don't know. It depends if it would carry over or not. I'm not sure if he'd carry that mindset over if he was dealing with the people. If
well, why would you think that when he's acted as why would you think that when he's acted his entire life in one way that somehow when he gets sworn in or get you know just like somebody is a criminal all their life but if you put a uniform on them they somehow become a good guy? I mean, you know, we don't take former convicts and make them cops. So why would he all of a sudden turn around and do the right thing?
By changing his focus. If he could do that.
Well, it's a lot of wishful thinking. I think Donald Trump's big contribution is to open up this stale process to discussion. And if we have a discussion, we might have something emerge on some real issues. Right now, we're just going to have a bunch of prepared speeches unless we have somebody like Donald Trump. So I'm glad that he did that. I'm glad that he threw some fireballs. I hope he opens up the discussion tonight. But I have big questions about what he has done with Hillary and Bill and other politicians, how he has bought influence. And I have to ask myself, is this still going to be about the Donald? Does he want to become president so that he can become a much, much richer man? You know, we had the Clintons who are basically trailer trash in their words. That's what they called people who are working class. They call them trailer trash. Well, that's the background that the Clintons came from. They became multi-millionaires when they became president. Well, on the other side, we've got Obama, who was a community organizer. He'd never had a job. He'd never had a business, but he became a multi-millionaire once he became president. So what does a billionaire become when he becomes president? Is he going to use that to make himself richer? Because that's what he was saying he was using his political connections for, was to make himself richer. That's why he spread the money around with these people.
The bottom line of all this, here's my thought regarding this whole thing, what you're saying, is that the big fear that it's going to be between Donald and Bernie Sanders, and that's going to cut out their golden boy, Jeb Bush, and it's going to cut out all the good shepherds that want to lead the flock, and it's going to cut all of them out. And that's why they keep trying to push Donald into saying that he wants to be a third party. He doesn't want to be in a third party. He said, I'll only be a third party candidate if they do something so horrendous and so egregious that I'm forced to not run. He says, they have to do something really unkind to me, and then I would come in as a third party. He says, I don't plan to be a third party.
Let me ask you this, Sherry. Assuming right now that your guy's not going to get in, whoever that is, what could you do locally that would really make a difference? Because you don't have a whole lot of control over who gets in as president. What is it at local level that you think you could make the biggest difference?
The only way I ever felt like I could ever make a difference in anything is through my writing and through my website, which I haven't been able to pursue much this last few years because of the house I bought and everything. But it's calling this show and another show I used to call in on 4 years. And it gave me a sense of like, we are being heard. We can speak to each other this way. I don't do it through email. I don't put anything in writing because that's stuff they use against you.
Sure.
If I put on anything political on my site and it wasn't just more spiritual, they come pick me up for the stuff I have to say, but I can say it on this show, and I have said it on other shows that won't take my calls anymore. And this is great for me, David.
Well, exercising your freedom of speech is very important, and we need to understand that there are many people who want to take our freedom of speech, even on relatively innocuous things. But I guess the question is, is there any issue that you really think if you organize people on that issue other than just who to vote for, do you think that you could make a difference?
If an issue other than
something that could be controlled at a local level, or is there local politicians that you get involved with, or are you
I'm not really a political person at all.
Okay.
I look at how what's good for people and what's right for people. It has nothing to do with politics. Really, history and all that was never my interest in school. It was all English and art. This mm-hmm. this is poli- politics, I really don't know a lot about. I just know when I see something, like I see something with the socialism, there's a difference between democratic and totalitarianism, and people don't understand. It's all about what's being restricted. You know, you restrict someone's democracy, that's not democratic socialism. If you restrict the untammeled workings of an economic market.
Well, I want to get to somebody. Thank you for calling. I'm going to go on to another caller because I want to give other people who've been on hold a chance. But I'll just say to people who are not interested in politics, and I understand because it is hard to have an effect on it. But, you know, the old saying, if you're not interested in politics, that doesn't mean politics isn't interested in you. They will come for you if you passively sit there and ignore what's going on. Let's go to Matt in Oklahoma. Matt, you wanted to talk about Planned Parenthood?
Hey, Dave, what's going on?
Hey, I'm fine. What's up?
Yeah, actually, I just had a couple things to say real quick. I'll try to top them off here. We were talking about Donald Trump for a moment, and I just wanted to mention that he is no Ross Perot, and that he is definitely the Don. I'll go ahead and move on to my point that I wanted to make, is that CNN, last night it was kind of, you know, I saw some people saying, oh, you know, Planned Parenthood, you know, it was a hoax. CNN says it was a hoax video. And I wasted too much time last night addressing that, and I'm not sure how you try to tell somebody, hey, you know, CNN is just mainstream media.
I don't know if you caught the program a couple of days ago. Doug Hagman was on and live with us, and he's somebody who is a licensed private investigator in several states. He's got a CEO of an organization that does that. And he pointed out that this is the way investigations are always done. It's entrapment if you go somewhere and somebody's got an unrelated business to some criminal activity. Let's say that you're looking for somebody smuggling bombs into the country. And this guy, the example he uses, is a pizza owner. And you've got absolutely no reason to think this pizza owner is involved in any kind of bomb smuggling. But you set up a sting operation to encourage him to think that he's going to do bomb smuggling, and then you give him all these different things and facilitate that. That's what we see the FBI doing over and over again to prove that we have a terrorist threat. But if it's somebody that has a business that is an arms business and there's been reports that they're smuggling bombs and that sort of thing, then you do a sting. And we see this kind of investigation. That is a legitimate investigation. And that was what was done with Planned Parenthood. This is not a hoax video. This is not editing. He said, in all of his investigations, those are always the alibis that people use. This is a sting. And what you see there, people will watch it. They will understand that. Stay with us. We'll be right back with more of your calls. We're going to be joined by Jim Mars in the next hour. He's going to be live here in the studio with us for an entire hour. We're going to talk about population control, the many different ways that the eugenicists, the globalists, are trying to use population control. But I want to go back to your calls right now. Let's go to Jim in Georgia. Jim, you wanted to talk about abortion.
Hey, it's a pleasure to speak with you, David.
Thank you for calling. Go ahead.
Well, I think
your call is breaking. Can you try one more time? I think we're getting a breakup on your call. We've lost Jim. Okay, let's go to Scott in Washington. Scott, you wanted to talk about the presidential race? Go ahead.
Actually, I wanted to talk a little bit on the left side of the dial. And I wanted to talk about two things about Bernie Sanders, and I don't think which has come out. The first thing, and I verified this, apparently he had still does have a chair on the Committee for the Veterans Affair when this whole scandal came out, and I came across a little blurb about this, but somehow he's not answered about the stuff that's been going on with the VA, and I had addressed one of his, which I call him the Sandinista followers, about, you know, what was his position or what specifically had he done to address any of these issues, and you know, they just kind of talked around it and talked about, you know, all the legislation he did for the poor and blah, 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 and what other candidate has addressed that. And I turned it back on him. I said, well, I'm asking this question of him specifically since, as far as I know, he's the only presidential candidate that has a chair specifically. So what is he doing to address it? And the other thing, quickly, and I haven't confirmed this, but I came across another blurb that indicated that one of his Senate races when he was running, that he had received over $5 million from one of Hillary's PACs. Now, if he's so against, you know, money and politics and stuff like that, well, where does he think he gets her money if that story is true?
Well, he gets a lot of money from the Democrat National Party because he pretty much votes with them down the line. Yeah, that's a great point, Scott. If he's on the committee for Veterans Affairs, and you know, he doesn't really have much to say about that. But of course, we see that with socialists, don't we? Isn't that what we were just talking about? How in Greece they said, "Oh, we'll give you a referendum," and then they have a referendum. It's like, never mind, that wasn't the result we wanted. So we're going to do what we had planned on doing anyway. We see it with Hugo Chavez, where they give all the money to the bankers and then let the people go begging for food, water, and medicine. And now they've got 800% hyperinflation on their currency there. So we see this over and over again. That's how the socialists roll. There's also the hypocrisy of Bernie Sanders calling for a $15 an hour minimum wage being imposed from Washington while he pays some of his staffers as low as $12 an hour. So it's a good point. As this is all just starting, I'm certainly not a Bernie Sanders supporter. He comes across as very open and genuine as in contrast to Hillary Clinton, but we need to look at his policies, not get caught up in personalities. That's the key thing. Let's go to Amicus in North Carolina. You said you wanted to talk about Trump. Go ahead.
I like Trump because he's not a wimp. He's actually made his money from the sweat of his back and brow a few times, come back from the grave financially more than a few. And it doesn't come off like a wimp like the Pauls and the rest of these established cronies who can't get nothing done.
Well, I agree. He does come across as a very strong personality. He does have a very strong personality. I have questions about whether he did make his money by the sweat of his brow, or did he make it with crony capitalism? That's why he was greasing the palms of the Clintons and the other people he now supposedly adamantly opposes. Stay with us. We'll continue with your phone call. Welcome back to the Alex Jones Show. I'm David Knight. We're going to be joined live in studio in the next segment with Jim Mars. We'll be talking about population control, the many various aspects of that. In this segment, I want to try to take as many calls as I can. Now, we got people who have been on hold for a while. Let's go to Mike in Tennessee. Mike, you want to talk about corruption in Tennessee, you said. Go ahead.
Good afternoon, David. This is Mike in Tennessee, and I've been trying to contact you for over 3 months. I've sent email after email. I must be sending it to the wrong place, but right now, the state of Tennessee is effectively disarming the state by going after people who are either related to or friends with someone once convicted of a felony. Here's how the routine works. If you're convicted of a felony and you go visit a friend, they will raid their house, steal their guns, and put that person in jail, charging them with possession of guns, even though the guns be locked up in a safe or in another room, and you don't even know they're there. They're effectively disarming the state and keeping the prisons full of people who are otherwise going about their own business, not harming anybody.
Wow. We'll take a look at that. That's what we're seeing over and over again. Any kind of an excuse to take people's weapons. To say that a veteran is using or somebody who's on Social Security, that they're having their paycheck deposited automatically, that's a sign of mental incompetence, and we need to go ahead and take their guns from them. And now we're seeing this at the national level. The NRA and Senator Cornyn from Texas are now talking about voluntarily enacting state laws that would increase the reporting of background checks to the feds so they can then scrutinize people. We'll look into that. Thank you so much for letting us know that, Mike, in Tennessee. Let's go to Derek in Wyoming. Derek, you wanted to talk about local solutions. Go ahead. Oh, he dropped off. Okay, let's go to Anthony in Florida.
Hello?
Hey, how you doing? You wanted to talk about Hiroshima, the anniversary. Go ahead.
Yes. I have believed for a long time that just like in Germany and in Italy, there were Japanese people who spoke out against the aggressive militaristic policies of the government at that particular time, but they were silenced in one form or another, the Japanese people basically, paid the price for leading blindly. Having the government lead them into war like that.
Oh, absolutely. There'll always be people who see what is going on. And that's the thing that we should all be concerned about. When we watch this debate tonight, we need to recognize that it is both parties that have been cavalier about this escalation of militarized intention. We have fomented revolution on Russia's borders. We have revived the Cold War. It looks like we've got people, not only Obama, but of course the cheerleaders for the military-industrial complex and the GOP are far worse. They want more done. They want a war with Russia. They want a war with Syria. They want a war with Iran. There isn't anybody they don't want to go to war with because they want to sell weapons to the military-industrial complex. I would encourage everybody to go back and we forget about all the military strategy with all this stuff and how the war started, who was on which side. Just look at it and imagine yourself at the epicenter of this nuclear bomb and say, do we want to continue this crazy arms race? Look at the articles that we put up about the war scenario of 2050, what it's going to be like in 35 years, and ask yourself, do we want to continue down this road? Do we want to have leaders who are always looking from the most belligerent standpoint to try to get involved in a war somewhere? Let's go to Michael in New York. Michael, you wanted to talk about Donald Trump, I think? Go ahead.
Yes, thank you, David. And actually, the previous callers and the whole conversation ties in with my points on Trump. As with any presidential candidate, let's get right down to it. Will Trump really get us out of the United Nations? This is all comes down to these wars and the confiscation of the guns. All of this is pertaining to United Nations takeover. Now, I want to know if Trump, and of course, I'd love to be able to ask him directly, or any other presidential candidate, which we know the answer will be no to that.
But oh, yeah, Trump, and of course, what's driving all that is the Federal Reserve and the bankers. Stay with us. That's all the time we got for calls. We'll be right back with Jim Mars. Joining me this hour is Jim Mars, and we're going to talk about population control, a lot of different aspects of that. Before we get to that, I want to let you know about the specials that we have at InfoWarsLife.com. Of course, we've extended free shipping for everything at InfoWarsLife.com for one more week. That is about to end. That's not going to be extended. We did that as a thank you. We extended our free shipping for the month of July. We also have a special on Silver Bullet. Buy two Silver Bullet, get two free for a limited time only. Silver Bullet is a powerful colloidal silver product that is both free of artificial additives and perfect for your preparedness supply. Concentrated to 30 parts per million and a base of pure deionized water, there's a reason that our listeners have dubbed Silver Bullet as their preparedness silver. And again, you can get that buy two, get two free, 50% off. And today, for just one day, we have a flash sale, 30% off of OccuPower. That's for 24 hours. OccuPower is specifically designed to nutritionally assist the natural function of healthy eyes. Everything that you get at InfoWarsLife.com is free shipping today. Thank you for supporting us, and we really appreciate that. That's why we extended that for this week. Now, joining me now is Jim Mars of JimMars.com. Of course, Jim is no stranger to the viewers here at InfoWars, and I wanted to get him back to talk about his book, Population Control. You were here a couple of weeks ago talking to Alex about population control. And I wanted to focus, we were talking just before we came back, the two fallacies that are underlying the global governance and population control. Tell us about those two fallacies.
Right. Well, at the very top of the food chain, and I'm not talking about politicians or presidents or even presidents, vice presidents of these corporations. I'm talking about the people that own them, control them. We talked about that last time, how that one person may only own 10% of a company's stock, but if nobody else owns more than that, then they're the controlling
interest. That's right, yes.
Okay. Their basic fallacy in their argument is that, and there are numerous people I could quote, who say that the underlying problem in the world today is overpopulation. It's just too many people. Okay. And I guess if you live in a big city, you're caught in a traffic jam, it's easy enough to buy into that, right? Especially here in Austin. But just try going down I-35.
Yeah.
But it's a fallacy. And here's why. The Oklahoma Chamber of Commerce did a study and realized that the entire 7.5 billion population of the world could live comfortably enough in the state of Oklahoma. Mm-hmm. Now, if you want to spread out, come to Texas. Or if you want an acre or so for every person in the world, go to Australia. So in other words, there's really not truly an overpopulation problem. There is a population concentration problem. Because you got everybody piled in these big metropolitan areas.
And they want to make that worse because they want to control. It isn't necessarily that they have a problem with the number of people. They're just concerned that control may get out of their hands.
Exactly.
And you never know who's going to rise up. You might have a Beethoven, or you might have somebody else that's going to rise up politically.
And if they're spread out, you really lose control.
Mm-hmm.
In fact, you know, David, if you go back and look at the whole history of the Western civilization, you know, it started at the Fertile Crescent there in Mesopotamia, where now is the one place we can't freely travel to, which is Iraq. Mm-hmm. And then it spread north into the Caucasus and then south to Palestine and Egypt and then Greece, Rome, filled up Europe, went to the British Isles, filled them up, and then moved over to the east coast of America. And then during the 19th century, it all spread westward until, you know, there's no place left to go. That's right. But everybody was moving westward. And why? Well, the historians make no big secret about it. Everybody moved throughout history to try to escape religious and political tyranny.
Yes.
And this is, we're now here in the 21st century facing the same problem, but we got no place to run to.
That's right.
We're going to have to stand and fight.
Well, as we've said many times, there was that article that was written probably about 10 years or so ago, The Future Doesn't Need Us. And they were talking about how, and Alex has mentioned this many times, where the elitists would say, well, do we just kill everybody or do we just make them stupid and passive, right? Those are two alternatives. And they look at all these things, this explosion of robots, this explosion of artificial intelligence, and they really believe that they don't need us as slaves. Because remember, robot came from the Czech word or the Slavic word for slave.
Mm-hmm.
So it was just a slave worker. They can replace us as their slave workers with a robot, and the robots aren't going to challenge them unless they have the AI get out of control. Now they're starting to worry about that.
Well, you see what happened at McDonald's when they started pushing for $15 an hour, and in Europe they've already started here, and will be pretty quick. They're replacing them with touchstone computers.
Oh, yeah.
Touch computers.
That'll accelerate it. Exactly.
Hey, we'll just get a machine to take your place. You know?
That's right.
That's the whole thing. But here, you know, and I know Alex, and I know you too, I think, has talked about the Georgia Guidestones.
Yes.
Okay, so, and a lot of people feel like that this monument in Georgia pretty well reflects the goals of the New World Order. And the very first admonition says, maintain humanity at 500 million in perpetual balance with nature.
Mm.
Well, boy, that sounds great. But that begs the question.
Who's got to go?
Yeah. What happens to the other 7 billion of us? And more importantly, who decides who's going to go and who's going to stay? And as you said, you've got two choices. You can either kill people or you can slowly dumb them down and cull the fringes. And this is what's happening now, because in Nazi Germany, they took depopulation to its logical conclusion, which is we have some people we don't like, so we just kill them.
Population control, political control always devolves into a genocidal control, into democide. And that's one of the reasons why we so adamantly support the Second Amendment, because that's our voice in all of this, to keep that from happening ultimately. And of course, you mentioned the Georgia Guidestones. That was something that people are still saying, well, you know, who put this monument to population control up anonymously here? Very suspicious about that. A lot of people believe that it might have been Ted Turner, because he has advocated the same types of policies and is right there in Georgia, a good suspect. But now they're coming out openly. Now we see the Pope bringing in John Schellenhuber, who is a German scientist who has preached for population control, radical reduction, just like we see with the Georgia Guidestones, brings him in as a Vatican scientific advisor, right? At the same time, they're pushing for global control and the pretext of climate change, and talking about how they need to have a global court, a planetary council, writing laws, and so forth and so on. Full-out global governance, and we've got the Pope pushing that and ignoring all the things that the Catholic Church has traditionally stood for. Family, stopping abortion, all it has nothing to say about any of this stuff. It's all full-on global governance.
All the gloves are off. And let's consider John Holdren, okay, very scientific guy. And a few years back, along with Paul Ehrlich and his wife, they published a book. And in the book, he said, well, one of the things we might do is put sterilization chemicals in the water supply, you know, and we could always have an anecdote for the people that we want to keep alive, you know.
Mm-hmm.
Now, you know, that kind of thinking, and you can argue back and forth on that, but the point here is John Holdren today is Obama's science advisor,
yes,
his science czar.
Yes.
So the guy head of Presidential Science Advisory, you know, is on the record as saying, yeah, perhaps we need to reduce the population with sterilization. And just to show you that, hey, these people aren't kidding. They want to kill you, okay? Because let me quote Prince Philip at Windsor's, okay, the royal family of England. He says once that if he is reincarnated, he wants to come back as a deadly virus to help solve the population overpopulation problem.
Well, you know, he's part of the Earth League, and there, again, that's the connection. This guy, Sheldon Hoover, is one of the people that's on the Earth League that is also now intimately connected with the Pope, so it connects all these guys together on the same agenda, the same globalist agenda, and he calls it the Earth League. I was looking at it, and it made me think about that movie, as I think is based on a cartoon, the League of Extraordinary Gentlemen.
Yeah.
Where they were actually like monsters, right? Like Jekyll and Hyde was one of them.
Jekyll
okay,
Hyde
so it's like these guys they've got one face that they put out to the public, but behind it, you know, they secretly want to destroy as many people as possible because that's really where population control leads. We talk about putting stuff in the water. Don't you think it ought to raise flags with people when the government starts mass medicating us in the water supply? I mean, doesn't that even the people who think that this is somehow going to stop cavities, okay? Right. By drinking all this stuff, you got to ask them, and I constantly do, and I've never had one give me an answer yet. I said, okay, you think this is effective medication. What medication do you ever take where you don't control the dosage, where you give the same dosage to a child as you do to an adult man, right, or you don't even know what that dosage is because you've dumped it into the water supply? Somebody might get a super concentrated amount of it. Mm-hmm. Other people might get none of it. I mean, that's the insanity, but we just accept that because they tell us to do that, and we know that the agenda behind that is one of, at the very least, the obvious agenda is getting rid of the toxic waste for the people who are doing this. They just dump it in our water. Stay with us. We'll be right back with Jim Mars, jimmars.com. Joining me is Jim Mars. Now, Jim Mars is an award-winning journalist and author. After graduating from the University of North Texas with a degree in journalism, Mars worked for and owned several Texas newspapers before becoming an independent journalist and author. His website is jimmars.com, and we're talking about his new book, Population Control. There you go. Show it to the camera. Population Control. What's the subtitle there? How corporate owners are killing us. Tell us how they're killing us, Jim.
Talking about involuntary medication,
yes,
which is what happens when they put sodium fluoride in your water.
A waste product of the aluminum and nuclear industries. They would have had to pay a lot of money to get rid of that, but then they could charge us to dump it in our drinking water.
Well, after World War II, there were international conventions, and they banned the dumping of sodium fluoride, among many other chemicals, into the water supply because it would go in the ocean, right, and it infected everybody. So now they can't dump it somewhere, so they put it in our water supply and we drink it. How brilliant is that?
Yeah.
And they say, yeah, but it reduces cavities. Yes, but according to studies I've read, only for children, mostly boys, between the age of 6 and 12. Mm-hmm. And
if it's effective as a medication, let people have the informed consent to decide that they want to do that.
Exactly.
And then take it as a medicine instead of trying to mass medicate the public through the water supply where nobody can control the dosage. Doesn't that concern you that they're giving you something that many people think is toxic and you have absolutely no control over the dosage? That ought to concern you. Look at this particular article, Jim. Monsanto sued over PCB contamination of Spokane River in Washington State. They say that PCBs were banned back in 1979. They say, in spite of this, Monsanto knew they were toxic. They could not be contained. They would escape into the environment. But despite knowing all the risk imposed, Monsanto increased the production. And now in Spokane, they're saying they're going to spend $300 million to keep the PCBs from entering the river system. They're now suing Monsanto over this. So we see this happening all the time.
Well, they spend $300 million trying to clean up the river, and they spend another $300 million as a fine to the federal government, for example, if they say, you've been doing this or something really wrong. So there's $600 million. Now, to us, that that's a big deal. To them, that's pocket change.
That's right.
When you're talking about $23 and $30 billion around the world, but we get off lucky there. They're only here. They're destroying the environment. Monsanto's been sued all around the world for killing people. Mm-hmm. Okay, and that's not even to mention there's some people have died from breathing their stuff or toxic water, and that's not even to mention the 20,000 or 30,000 Indian farmers who've committed suicide because they got sold this Monsanto
GMO stuff,
GMO and seeds and stuff, and it didn't work, and they needed more water, and they went broke, and they've committed suicide. And
or they come in and say, when they cross-pollinate and contaminate their crops, they say, now you owe us royalties on this. It's not a trespass.
Yeah.
It's a copyright infringement. And we've had the Supreme Court essentially uphold that. And, of course, Clarence Thomas used to be a Monsanto lawyer. So it all works out really well.
Well, you hadn't watched. Right now, several states have already legalized marijuana, right?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. And already a lot of the wealthy guys are jumping in trying to buy land so they can grow that. Okay. The U.S. government has a patent on medical marijuana. Maybe that's why now they're getting more and more lenient about it. And I'll bet you anything, it ends up in the hands of a large corporation, probably Monsanto. And then they'll have a patented pot. Mm-hmm. And then if you grow some and they can show that yours looks similar to theirs, then they sue you because you're using their patented seeds and crop.
Oh, yeah.
They're absolutely already doing that on food crops, right?
The only way we're going to get out of this, of course, is if we have the freedom to innovate. And there's a story that I think is interesting. I'll just pass on real quickly to people. It's on trueactivist.com. This mycologist, that's somebody who studies mushrooms, holds a patent that could destroy Monsanto. Let's certainly hope so. They say Paul Stamets has figured out how to use Mother Nature to safely control over 200,000 species of insects. They say that this is a patent that he's had since 2006. I don't know if this is being suppressed or what, or maybe there's nothing to it. I don't know.
Well,
I mean, take a look at it. That what it does is kind of interesting. These particular mushrooms will basically draw insects to them. When the insects eat this, the insects basically turn into fungi themselves from the inside out. So this is not something that gets into your food. This is not something where they had to genetically modify your food so they could then spray glyphosate on it,
mm-hmm.
okay, which is what Monsanto does. Doesn't put any kind of toxic pesticides into it, because that's the problem with a lot of their GMO stuff, is that they systemically add these chemicals into the food itself, so you can't even wash it off. It's in there systemically. It's not even on the surface.
Well, all I can say is, if that's true, Paul better watch himself, because he's liable to have a one-car accident.
That's true. We've seen that many times, haven't we? It's nothing to joke about, folks. It actually does happen, and it seriously does. It's not just a joke. Stay with us. We're going to be right back with Jim Mars. We're also going to take some of your calls. If you want to call in, that number is 800-259-9231. We'll be right back with Jim Mars. Joining me in studio is Jim Mars, an award-winning journalist and author. We're talking about his book here, Population Control, How Corporate Owners Are Killing Us. We were talking about one of the fallacies that they sell us over population in the last couple of segments. I want to move to another one that we were talking about here in your book, peak oil. Tell us about the fallacy of peak oil, Jim.
Well, peak oil was determined way back there in the 1950s by a academic named Hubert, and Hubert decided that by the year 2000 we were going to run out of oil. You know, there's first off, actually, you go back and there's a huge controversy over what is oil anyway.
Mm-hmm.
You know, we've all been taught that this is dinosaurs and ferns that are crunched under the earth and built up by millions of years, and mm-hmm. it produces this black gooey stuff that we can
refine. They spent a lot of money at the World's Fairs.
Right, exactly.
They created the Sinclair Dino logo. I mean, it's all about that narrative.
But the problem is, some of the so-called depleted oil reservoirs around the world are refilling.
Mm-hmm.
And I've spoke with some scientists, including some Russian scientists, who say that it is not fossil fuel. It is a hydrogen cracking process that takes place deep within the earth, and it just oozes up and then fills up these cavities. And the reason they thought it was organic was because back in the 1800s, when they first discovered oil and how it could be used to grease the wheels of the Industrial Revolution, they studied it and they found organic bits in it. So that's where they come up with the idea that it originates as crushed plants and animal life, you know. But in reality, it's the blood, lifeblood of the planet, and it comes up, fills up these old cavities where the cavemen had lived and cave lions and everything else, and plants got in there, and this is mm-hmm. where it picked up the bio. But that's a whole controversy itself.
But it's always been about political power. I remember going back and reading a biography of J.D. Rockefeller. Okay, how did he get his money? Well, he was of the age that he should have been fighting in the Civil War, but he paid somebody to take his place. And they had just discovered oil in Pennsylvania. And they thought, right, this is the only place in the world where this exists.
And he,
so
got,
he goes up there and got control of the refineries up there.
Not only that, but he worked tandem with Mr. Harriman, who was the railroad guy, owned all the railroads. And they made a deal. And anybody else who tried to get in the oil business couldn't ship their oil cheaper than Rockefeller because he had a deal with the guy that owned the railroad.
That's right.
And yeah, it's been, you know.
I mean, first they thought it was only in Pennsylvania. Then they discovered it in Texas. Like, oh, no. So then they got to find a way to, like you said, with the railroads and everything, to get the refinery monopoly in Ohio. Then it broke out in the Middle East. And it's like, now what are we going to do? I don't know. I got the answer. War.
Well, what happened in the Middle East was a bunch of Russians got together and said, we need to create Zionism.
Yeah.
So we can have, we'll say we need a homeland in the Middle East, but actually we can get our foothold in the oil-rich Middle East. But and the things going on today, and this leads us back to the idea of peak oil. It's a fallacy. It's not true. Anybody tries to tell you that we're running out of oil, give them three words: Bakken Rock Formation, B-A-K-K-E-N. Check it out. That is a huge underground reservoir of raw petroleum that has not been tapped. It's under North Dakota, Montana, into Canada. And the experts have said that there's enough petroleum underground there to last us at increased rates of consumption for the next 2,000 years.
Okay? Well, you know, when you were here last, I showed you that magazine. It was Time or Newsweek. 1979, remember?
Right.
They had it plotted out. 8.7 years are going to be out of oil.
That's right.
Another, you know, 9.6 years where we're going to be out of gas and everything. But even then, they said it was going to be 500 years before we ran out of coal. Okay. And they didn't have clean technology to use coal, but they do now. And
they,
that's something
now,
that, I mean, not even the Bakken oil fields. You could talk about the coal reservoirs that we got, but there's so many different places that we could go for oil resources. And as you pointed out, you know, the peak oil is something that's been sold to us heavily, not just by the corporations, but by the CIA, because it is a way for them to exert control through their wars. It gives them an excuse to have wars.
And it's bogus. And on top of being bogus, it's killing us through the pollution.
Mm-hmm.
You know, we don't need to be dependent on oil. You know, we could be turning to solar, geothermal, tidal power, you know, and all kinds of things. But of course, Nikola Tesla showed us how to get basically free energy, but it's all been squashed by the New World Order people who want to keep control over their monopoly of petroleum. And the main thing about this fallacy of peak oil is that when you really get down to it, the idea that we have to find more oil and gas is the whole reason behind fracking.
Mm-hmm. It,
which is now becoming a big hot topic of people. And fracking, by the way, in case you really don't know, is hydraulic fracturing, where they take water up to 8 million gallons per well, and there's like 500,000 wells in the United States, and they add up to 40,000 chemicals, including deadly stuff like uranium and toxic metals and stuff.
They got to have somewhere to put it, Jim.
They pump it down in the ground.
That or
under
put it
pressure.
In our drinking supply and charge us for that.
Well, if these fracking wells don't pan out and get stopped, they will. They'll probably put in our drinking water and tell us it'll help us sleep or something, you know.
Absolutely.
So they pump this water in there, and then the thing is, they have to, then after they open up the cracks underground, and by the way, they put steel ball bearings down there to keep the cracks open, all right? And this has led, of course, to unnatural earthquakes.
Yeah,
all around
yeah,
the country.
Yeah.
In Oklahoma, you know, 20, 30 years ago, they had maybe one earthquake a year. And now they had about 30 just in the first months of 2015.
Sam, you're just a conspiracy theorist.
Yeah, I'm just a conspiracy theorist. But the whole idea is we got to have
when
more.
When you see something that's unusual like that, you start to say, this is something that's new. And then we have this other thing over here that's also new. Maybe there's a relationship with it. That's how investigations start, right?
Right.
I mean, you look at this kind of stuff and you try to, it's like, okay, well, let's explore this further. I mean, every hypothesis, every scientific hypothesis, every criminal investigation always starts with a theory.
What?
But of course, they're always say it's a conspiracy theory.
You know what my definition of a conspiracy theorist is, don't you?
What's that?
That's a person who questions proven liars.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah, the government, in other words. Yeah, because it's the government that weaponized that term. The government
yes.
that created that term in the wake of the Kennedy assassination, and they have used it ever since. And it seems to be effectively working. I mean, that's they can keep using the same playbook because nobody's catching on to the playbook for the most part. That's just a way to dismiss somebody's argument. Oh, you're a conspiracy theorist.
Right.
Yeah.
That's exactly right. So here are two of the biggest arguments we have now. Oh, but before we finish up on fracking, here's the thing that bothers me. Up in Denton County, which is next county over from where I live, we're North Texas University of North Texas. And, you know, they got together and they passed a local ordinance that says no more fracking here because we're having damage. We're having wells being polluted.
Mm-hmm.
And what happens is Governor Abbott pushed through legislation here in Austin that says local authorities cannot ban fracking.
Well, see, that happens everywhere. That happens typically with Monsanto.
Right.
We saw the farmers who really understand that when they go in and they have these labeling referenda, the people are very easily deceived. Typically, they come in and 90% of the people say, yeah, I'd like to know what's in my food. Yeah, why not have that on the label? And they come in and say, no, you really don't want that on your. Let me tell you why you don't want to have that on your. It's going to be so expensive. You won't be able to afford to eat because it's going to be so expensive for us to tell you what the ingredients in your food, right?
Right.
And so then they change
around. We might
have around,
to change a fodder or yeah. a letter or two. On
but
the
when they go into, they've had success when they went into a small community, a city, a county area, and it was a rural area where the farmers understood about the trespass of these Monsanto GMO things, and they voted to keep it out. And it happened in Hawaii, and Monsanto spent like $8 million to stop it. They still could not stop that because the people there understood the problem, and they couldn't be deceived with these slick television ads.
Right.
So what they do.
Unlike the people in California.
Exactly. So what they do, they shut it down at the state level.
Yeah.
And then we've got the labeling laws being shut down, just got with the DART Act.
The
just
DART
got
Act.
Shut down mm-hmm. at the national level. Of course, that hasn't gone through the Senate. People don't give up on that yet. You need to
contact
talk to your
senator.
That's
tell
right.
them, you know, GMO labeling. What about freedom? Do you not understand? You know,
what is it? Why,
at the
why
very
is it
least,
a crime for us to know what's in our food?
Exactly.
And of course, when we talk about GMO, we don't know what they're going to do in the future, right? We don't,
right.
It's even if you believed that everything that they've done genetically right now, and this is transgenic genetic modification, this isn't just selective breeding, but wouldn't you want to know in the future if they're going to start doing some of this? Wouldn't you want to know that that's in your food? But they shut it down at the national level. And then just in case that doesn't work, and because there's some countries that have said we want to know what's in our food or they have banned GMO, they're going to use these secretly negotiated treaties, the Trans-Pacific, the Trans-Atlantic Partnerships, the TTIP.
That's why they don't want people to know what's in them. That's
right. And they don't want you to know what's in the laws, and they don't want you to know what's in the food. It's kind of like what Bismarck said, right? You don't want to know what's in a sausage, and you don't want to know how the legislation gets made, right? And so that's what they're doing. They don't want us to know what's in our food, and they don't want us to know how they're creating this treaty.
And David, I'm sorry, but to me, that makes a mockery of the idea that we are a free and democratic people.
Oh, absolutely.
You know, yeah. Because to me, a free and democratic people is a people who can actually study an issue and look at it from all sides and then vote intelligently, not through secret under the table deals.
Mm-hmm. Or people who are treated like adults. Who have informed consent.
Yes.
Of course, when you look at what they're doing with vaccines, they're trying to take away our informed consent left and right, dictating to us, arguing from authority, ignoring any arguments from the other side, demonizing people who would say that. But of course, what should we expect when they have been doctrinating our, messing up our water with fluoride without our informed consent? If they can do that to our drinking water, why can't they force us the next step?
Take a shot.
Take a shot, exactly.
And what a lot of people don't realize is they keep saying, well, yeah, but vaccinations are harmless, you know, it's perfectly safe. Well, if that's so, then why back in the 80s did they pass the Vaccine Injury Compensation Fund?
That's right.
Okay, which, number one, absolves the pharmaceutical corporations of any liability if their vaccines go bad, okay? Mm-hmm. And if you have a child who's suddenly has a vaccination, then turns autistic, or even worse, other medical problems, you have to hire a lawyer, you have to go to the federal government, you have to go through this vaccine compensation fund, you have to prove up, and, you know, it takes more money, more time, which most people do not have. Mm-hmm. And even with that rigorous process, the government to this day has already paid out over $3 billion to families whose children have been harmed by vaccines. And yet they...
Why would they have to take away the liability? Why would they have to give them legal immunity if these were safe?
And if they're safe, why have they paid out $3 billion for vaccine injuries?
That's right.
In other words, now I'm not totally against vaccines. I mean, if I get cut with a rusty nail, I probably want to run get a tetanus shot, you know. But this on, I know. Well, that's, we'll get it.
I want to know what's in it. And because I can't get the truth in labeling even about my food, I'm not too certain about the vaccines either.
And so. That's the truth of it. That's the people who argue against vaccines, if I understand their arguments completely, it's not even particularly the vaccines, it's the additives.
Yes.
Thermarisol and I don't know.
But even if you support it, and when we saw this discussion in California, there was a doctor that testified there. He encourages his patients to get vaccines. He takes them himself. He believes in them. But he said, don't force people to do this.
Exactly.
I mean, that you can't take away people's informed consent. That's the path to medical tyranny.
Yep.
That's what that enables things like we saw in Auschwitz with Josef Mengele saying, this is for the good of all humanity that I am torturing these people. Okay? Yeah. I mean, we saw that the Japanese scientists did that. American scientists have done that at Tuskegee and everything.
I was going to say, don't forget the Tuskegee experiment. So, we've been doing that here, too.
Exactly. So, I mean, it's not limited to any particular nationality or country. We've seen this done over and over again for the good of all humanity. And they said at the Nuremberg trials, we're not going to accept that. We're going to draw the ethical line here that you can never do, even with a person's consent, you can't do things that are going to harm them. But one of the first stories I had when I came here, Jim, was looking at some tests that were being conducted by the EPA. They were trying to up the fine particulate matter regulations. And so what they did to make that happen, they deliberately searched for people who had respiratory and heart issues, and they hooked them up to a diesel exhaust pipe through an elaborate technique. They didn't know that's exactly where it went to. But that's essentially it. A hose that runs up, comes into a little room, and does that to them.
And you're looking breathing for exhaust.
An event. Yeah. And we were not able to stop and get a restraining order from a judge. So they continued to do that. And then they went to California and they selectively looked for young black teenagers who had respiratory issues and so forth. And then they came back to North Carolina and did it again. So we've got our own government violating the Nuremberg prohibitions for ethics because they had said on the head of the EPA, Lisa Jackson, had said, I'm not talking about making people sick. I'm talking about killing them. I'm saying that more people are dying from fine particulate matter than die from cancer. And they expose people to 70 times that in these experiments. So it's like, what's going on here? But that's our government. When you take away people's informed consent, treat them like animals, you're in a very dangerous situation.
Well, in my book, Population Control, what I really got really upset about, and I think you would be too, is the way that they're treating our veterans.
Yes.
They're experimenting on them. They're giving them experimental drugs. The amount of SSRI drugs or psychiatric drugs have gone from like 10 years ago or 15 years ago, the military was spending like $7 billion on those psychiatric drugs. Today, it's up to $40 billion. And, you know, they go to them and say, well, you're over in Iraq and you're having a tough time of it because it's 120 degrees. And by the way, your Diet Coke and Diet Dr. Peppers are sitting there in the sun baking and turning to formaldehyde because of the aspartame in it. And then they don't feel good. So they go to the medic and the medic says here and he gives them antidepressants and everything else.
Well, of course, we've seen this going on a long time. Today's the 70th anniversary of Hiroshima. What they do to the American soldiers. We've seen the videos where they took them out and used them as guinea pigs.
Marched them right up to within a few hundred yards of the atomic bomb blast and said, here, don't look at the blast.
You know? And then during the Iraq War, depleted uranium shells. They had said, these things are dangerous. And then they used depleted uranium in ways that they had previously prohibited. And so now we're seeing these types of things from our own soldiers, not to mention the people in Fallujah, the massive birth defects that have happened there.
Yeah, and by the way, you mentioned that fluoride, sodium fluoride, is a waste product, you know, of aluminum or a byproduct. But what I detail here in Population Control is how it was also a deadly waste product of the manufacture of atomic weapons.
Mm-hmm.
And they didn't know how to get rid of it.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
So they put it in our water supply and we drink it. How brilliant is that? And by the way, for some of you who think maybe I'm just a conspiracy theory and go talk to your dentist because he'll tell you, oh, it's really safe. It's great because that's what he's been told by the American Dental Association, who was hoodwinked by one or two controversial studies. But if you think this is just a bunch of hooey, get hold of a toothpaste that says with fluoride, look on the back, read carefully the little print, and it says if anyone under 6 year old happens to swallow this, call the CDC, call the poison control. Exactly. It's a poison. Why would anybody voluntarily put poison in their system?
Absolutely. Why would they? Well, the answer is in your book, isn't it, Jim? Population control. The people who tell us that overpopulation is one of the key issues before us and we have to reduce it. We're going to be right back talking to Jim Mars, award-winning journalist and author. Stay with us. We'll be right back. And joining me in studio is Jim Mars, award-winning journalist and author. We've been talking about his book, Population Control. We're going to go to some of your calls. We've had people waiting for quite some time, so we're going to take calls in this segment, and we'll do one segment of Overdrive as well. Before we continue and get back to Jim, I just want to let you know about the specials we have up at InfoWarsLife.com. We have free shipping that's been extended for one more week. It's about to run out. This is Thursday. It's going to be ending this week. We extended it 1 week after our July free shipping special. That's everything in the store, but we also have some specials in the store over and above the free shipping special. We have a buy two silver bullet, get two free special. So that's 50% off of silver bullet if you get two of them. We normally sell out of that during the winter months, so this is a good time to stock up on that, get it at 50% off. We also have a flash sale, 30% off Occupower for 24 hours. Occupower is specifically designed to nutritionally assist your natural function of healthy eyes. Of course, your retina cells are constantly being destroyed and being replaced, so you need to have something that is good for nutrition that will support that function. Also, we have Nascent Iodine Survival Shield X2. That is now in stock. That is something that is frequently out of stock at our store. That is in stock, and you can get that and anything else at the InfoWarsLife.com store. Free shipping just through this week. It's not going to be extended. Getting back to Jim, let's take, we were talking about the Georgia Guidestones earlier. We've got a caller here that wanted to talk about that. Let's go to Charles from Georgia. Charles, go ahead.
All right, how you doing?
Doing good.
Howdy.
It's a pleasure to be talking on the show again. First time I called in, I was talking to Mr. Alex Jones. I was talking about the homosexuality as far as it being articles about how the federal government got involved with it and everything, but now it's different because the Georgia Guidestones seem to be ignored a lot here in Georgia. I don't know why.
Have you seen them? Have you been there yourself?
No, I've only seen the we got documentary films that we put together about it. I'm also an activist and stuff now. And much like what my other friends are doing, they're just basically just sitting around doing nothing, playing video games, watching pornography on the internet and everything. And I'm actually out here talking about the truth and trying to educate people. I have my own crew, and we got videos posted up on YouTube. If you can look us up and see if you can get some of your audience, because we all need to work
together. Sure, give us that site. We'll put that out on there. What's your site? What's your YouTube channel?
The Nation of Truth.
Okay.
That's the name of us. And we have our newest video that we came out with where we're talking about the modern-day suffering of Christians. That's about Christian persecution. We also got the Exposure for Your Mind 3, where we get into Obama and how he is responsible for the Muslim Brotherhood in Egypt and everything.
Well, that's good. That's what we need is a lot of citizen journals. So as people, that was the Nation of Truth. Was that the name of the YouTube channel? People can go there and see your videos. Let's go to some more. We've had several people on hold for quite a long time. Let's go to Alex in Virginia. Alex, we're curious as to, you said you want to talk about racism and UFOs. What's the connection there?
No connection, just two separate topics.
Go ahead.
One, the racism. I used to go to school when I was in elementary school in Fort Lauderdale, Florida.
Hang on. We'll wait. We'll take it in the, for those of you who want to hear the call, you can see it on YouTube. We'll also, we have a live broadcast at InfoWars.com. Hold on. We're going to come back in Overdrive and take your calls and the people who are on hold right now. We'll be right back. InfoWars Nightly News tonight at 7 Central, 8 p.m. Eastern, for those of you who won't be joining us in Overdrive. And joining me right now is Jim Mars, award-winning journalist and author. We've been talking about his book, Population Control, and we are taking calls. We had just gotten to Alex in Virginia, and we ran out of time. Alex, go ahead with your question.
Hi. All right, so when I used to go to school in Florida, it was pretty much in the ghetto in South Florida, and they used to have Cracker Day Basically, it was when all the black kids would beat up on whatever white kids they wanted to. And they would either throw eggs at us, they would either jump us. But I never actually got jumped, but a lot of my friends did and stuff. And so people would stay home. I just thought it was interesting because I never hear any stories like that. And I spoke to a friend of mine who actually is from Florida, about the same age, and same thing used to happen to him in Miami. They had Cracker Day also, but they had their own little like gangs. So
that's interesting. Yeah, the narrative that they're feeding everybody in terms of white privilege to try to get things going is, of course, black people can't be racist. That's what they're told in the universities.
Right.
That's the so, you know, it doesn't cut both ways. But
well, I'm not going to get into it, but if you want to find out the truth of it, go to the FBI crime statistics and compare the black-on-white crime versus the white-on-black crime.
Mm-hmm.
Just
mm-hmm.
check them out. Check out those numbers. Yeah.
Did you have a question for Jim on UFOs, you said?
Yes, and then my other comic kind of question was, I've been looking into the whole UFO thing for a long time since I was little, because I used to have, you know, bad dreams and all kinds of weird stuff happening. But through my research, it seems that, like, the alien thing might also be not aliens from another planet, but, like, entities that are here, like, if you want to say demons or any kind of thing. If you look into, like, Jacques Vallée, the UFO researcher, mm-hmm. or John Keel, these guys, they've like come up with the theory that that's what it seems like it is. It's since the beginning of time how people have spoken about these demons or
let's get Jim's comments, because he's written a best-selling nonfiction book, Alien Agenda.
Right. And you're absolutely right. I have lived through the evolution of thought on UFOs. You go back to the 50s, and the vast majority of people, 80-90% of the population, disbelieve there's any life outside of the Earth. The few people who did believe said, well, the big question was, do they come from Mars or do they come from Venus, you know? By the 60s, 70s, we'd progressed a little bit. We'd landed on the moon. We knew more. So the question became, do they come from Alpha Centauri or do they come from Zeta Reticula 4, you know? And now today, we've even progressed further, and now it's, do they come from space, or do they come from another dimension? Do they come from another time? Okay, and I'm here to tell you the answer is yes. All of the above. There's for one thing, there are those who still argue that UFOs are nothing more than government secret test craft, okay? And I'll be the first to say that a good number of sightings, that's probably is the explanation, but not all of them. Mm-hmm. And the key thing is that if you really investigate, you find out that the UFO phenomena has been with us, with humankind, all the way back through recorded history. The Vyamas of the Hindus that are recorded in the Hindu Vedas, some of the oldest writing in the world. You've got Ezekiel and Wheel in the Old Testament. Mm-hmm. I mean, you know, you can keep going and not right on up to the cattle mutilations and the crop circles and everything else that's going on today. So I would simply say this. If any of you out there say, well, that's stupid, I'm not even going to consider that, then I'm telling you right now, you'll never be able to figure out what's going on in the world, because you're tossing out a big piece of the puzzle.
Absolutely. Well, I'm a Christian, so I believe in extraterrestrial intelligence and life.
Well, too, she mentioned demons, you know. Who knows? There is a metaphysical aspect to the whole thing.
That's true.
But, David, it comes down to our interpretation. If you and I are walking through the woods and a little green guy runs in front of us, you know, you may say, I saw an alien, and I may say, no, it was a leprechaun.
That's right.
There's something there, but we can differ on how we perceive it.
True. That's true. Well, that's all the time we have today. Sorry to the callers that are still on hold. Jim Mars, jimmars.com. Thank you so much, Jim.